Action. Good morning and welcome to the 25th meeting of the Education, Children and Young People Committee in 2024. We have apologies from Stephanie Callaghan and Evelyn Tweed today. However, we have Jackie Dunbar joining us again. Welcome back, Jackie. Our first item on our agenda is an evidence session for Stage 1 of the Education Scotland Bill, and today we're going to hear from two panels of witnesses. So I'll welcome our first panel, and we have Gavin Yates, who's the Executive Director of Connect, Megan Farr, Policy Officer, Children and Young People's Commissioner Scotland. Morning, Megan. And Garvin Seeley, Interim Executive Director of Intercultural Youth Scotland. Morning. We're going to go straight to questions from members, and I've got the opportunity to ask the first question today. And it's a bit of a generic catch-all question to find out what are your views on the bill and how well do you think the proposed structures are meeting the expectations of the panel, of yourselves, following on from the various reviews and reports that have taken place in the last few years? And Gavin, you've caught my eye, so I'm going to go to you first.
Right.
That's how it works.
Obviously, the bill falls into its kind of two sections. One, you know, the reform of the SQA, and then the other side of it is the inspection side. You know, and we're on record of saying that, you know, not all parents are agreed with either section, but we've surveyed our parents through Connect extensively. I think what's disappointing is we had a bill that's come forward, if you like, pre-Hayward, and I think that is a bit of a mistake in some ways. So we had the response for Hayward, but we had a bill in place already. And I think particularly on the qualification side of things, I think that's actually the wrong way to go about things. In general, I think we're quite disappointed, and I think the SQA are quite disappointed in some ways on the qualification side. I think they wanted the bill to be more ambitious. I think, you know, from our parents' point of view, they wanted something that was obviously going to be fair and going to be responsive. And I think the other thing is, from a parental point of view, parents are hardly mentioned in the bill at all. It's really, really scant. And that's actually disappointing because, you know, what we know from evidence is when parents are really involved in their children's education, it's like adding an extra term to a year, right? And unfortunately, with like a lot of these kind of framework bills, a lot of it is, well, we'll get to the meat of it in due course. And I think that's actually quite disappointing. From the qualifications point of view, you know, we accept there's a learner's charter there. We don't know what's going to be in that learner's charter. We certainly believe that parents and learners need to be absolutely involved in that. But why no parents charter? Why no framework for appeals and qualifications? It just seems that parents have been, unfortunately, slightly forgotten.
On some of those points that you've mentioned there.
So, all of that is fixable. Onto the other side of inspections, again, I think actually a lot of this is welcome. From the briefing that I've received, it's about having probably more inspections. That's a good thing. We want to see that. Because what are inspections actually for? They're to increase public confidence. And you can't do that unless you're in schools on a regular basis. So that's good. But again, what process is there for parents to get involved in that? How can parents alert the inspectorate? They can't. You know, the process is really simple at the moment. If you've got a problem, you go to your local authority. The local authority then will cogitate. And then if that doesn't come to anything, it goes to the SPSO. And the SPSO, as we know, has got a waiting list of 16 weeks. So when you exhaust that possibility, the parent and the learner might have gone through a year. And that's disappointing, actually. So actually, what we would like to see is a whistleblowing process that the public or a teacher can go to the inspectorate and say, please look at what's going on in teaching and learning in this school.
Again, we'll come to more of those themes as we go on. Can I come to Megan next and then Garvin? OK, thanks. Megan.
Thank you, Convener. I literally, when I was preparing for this, I looked back at what we'd said in the original consultation on what became this bill that we submitted to Scottish Government in November 2021. And we did quite a bit of work with our young advisers in preparing for that. And the key points that were at the very beginning of our consultation were, and our first sentence is, culture change is the objective. Rather than taking a narrow starting point in which the structure of agencies is reviewed, the conditions required for systemic reform should be the focus. Changes to national education agencies must improve their direct accountability to the wider community, and particularly to children and young people. Space must be created for children and young people's ongoing input into curriculum reform, And finally, children and young people need to be involved in all levels of governance, decision-making and scrutiny. I think a real opportunity has been lost in that this bill doesn't do that. There isn't a guaranteed representation for children and young people on the learner committee. The way that it's formulated, it could be an adult learner, and it could, likewise, on some of the other bodies, it could be a representative of learners' views. You'll have seen in our written submission our views on the word learner. I will talk about children and young people today, and I may just talk about children, but that's reflecting the language in the UNCRC. And the reason for that is that we absolutely recognise the importance of SQA qualifications to adults who are studying, adult learners, including obviously 18, 19 and 20-year-olds who are care experienced to come within our remit, but their needs are different from children, their position and points in life, and so both points of view need to be represented. We also made the comment about space, and that's about space that's child-friendly. We spoke with our young advisers in 2021, and we spoke again to them over the summer. We were lucky enough to get some of them together, despite the summer holidays, to respond to this call for views. And they both came. There are two different groups, because obviously children move on. So the young advisers we had in 2021, most of them are now over 18. So we have a new group this year. And they both spoke about the importance of a place that was designed for children, that was about children's views and hearing children's views. Putting a child into an adult committee doesn't empower that child, and it doesn't empower those children, however representative they are, just because children are almost conditioned in school to listen to the adults. So what we actually need is a space that children are able to express their views freely, and that takes resource. And that's the other thing that's missing, is there needs to be resource within these organisations to provide a child-friendly space. There's good examples. The Audit Commission is one we always talk about. Care Inspectorate, although their group are slightly older, and the Young Inclusion Ambassadors. There's really good examples of work being done to take children's views.
And again, we will be digging in and around the detail and specifics around those things, Megan. Anything else? Are you okay? Super.
HMIE, that's the flip side, actually. That we recognise there's a lot of good work being done in HMIE, and from the point of view of this bill, it would be a shame to see it delayed because of some of the other issues with the bill.
Great. And as I said, we'll pick up a lot of those things as we go forward. Garvin, over to yourself now.
Thank you. I share the view of my colleagues here. I think on a fundamental level, education is about training your brain to learn. And I think if the primary focus of many things is about public confidence versus the benefit to the actual learners, there can be challenges that arise. So Scotland has taken the bold step to absorb UNCRC into legislation, and this Learner's Charter is a brilliant opportunity to actually demonstrate one way in which it could be actually realised to make a difference to young people and children. This could engage children in the decision-making process and demonstrate what good governance looks like. As teachers, parents and adults who have the best interests of young people at heart, it's important to make sure that the people who are supposed to be benefiting from this are actually included. In general, when policy making is occurring, it's important that it doesn't have the focus of about us without us. So if it's about someone, they should be involved in the discussion, and specifically if they're there to benefit. So the respondent organizations, my colleagues here, have gathered and taken the time to provide evidence that's very relevant and succinct. It's important to realize the wisdom and experience that's brought. But from my experience representing black and minoritized young people across Scotland and talking with teachers and engaging with children on a regular basis, there's not often the sense of why are they in school and what are they there for. So the Learner's Charter could benefit from coordinated efforts to engage with young people and children, working better with local authorities and organizations such as those present here today to make sure that it actually includes them specifically and not by implication, so that if and when there are concerns, their voice can actually be an immediate port of call and not to the behest of the Qualifications Scotland.
Super. Okay, thanks for that. And as I said, some of the things that you've talked about there at a high level, we will dig under and go into more detail going forward as the questioning evolves throughout the morning. Can I come to Pam Duncan-Glancy, please?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. There have been suggestions throughout the process for this piece of legislation that the culture of SQA needs to be improved when the new body takes over. So can the panel say what it believes was or is wrong with the culture in SQA and what good corporate culture would look like instead?
Now, the problem is with any public service organisation, there are the facts, right, and there's the emotion, and they're both really important, right? So, for instance, one of the recent issues that SQA had, some of the exam results came out blank, and it was a really challenging 90 minutes. But in perspective, it's 90 minutes. But the problem is the emotion of that for parents. If you're one of those parents or one of those children that's waited for 90 minutes for, and you don't know how long that's going to be, it damages your confidence. And the problem for SQA, I think, has been that they've had some of these events that have damaged public confidence in the organisation, and their response sometimes has been, look, we've got this under control, everything's fine. And I think the reason why we've come to the point where we've got this bill, in some ways it's a kind of, it's the old Sir Humphrey thing of something must be done and this is something. But is it going to fundamentally change anything? Well, it could do. If the learner's charter, which is in the bill, is strong, if parents can be more involved, if the general public can get more confidence. But crucially, that means that young people need to have confidence in the exam system. And young people need to have confidence in the education system in itself. And that is a real issue. We did a survey recently with our members. What we found was that 1 in 3 young people couldn't get the choices that they wished to study at Nat 5. 1 in 5 couldn't get their choices at higher. So if you can't even, you know, get the subjects that you want to study. And OK, that's nothing to do with the SQA. That's a wider problem with the education system. But it reflects on your examination organisation. And I'll just leave it there. In terms of, you know, I have very good relationships with the senior leaders at the SQA. I genuinely think they're fundamentally really committed to do the best job that they can do. But changing public attitudes is a really, really difficult thing, as we all know.
Thank you.
Megan.
I think that agree with a lot of what Kevin's just said there, particularly around public confidence and children and young people's confidence in the SQA. When we're reflecting back on the work that I was involved in to an extent, but colleagues did a lot of work with the SQA during 2020 and 2021 with the issues around the alternatives to exams then, and I think a lot of confidence was damaged in how that was handled. But it does seem like every year there is something, and the response to it is a bit too slow, history being the example you've heard this year. And that distance between SQA and children and young people has been a recurring theme right the way through. It's still the way that our young advisors felt when we spoke to them this year. They feel like there's sort of almost no way they can feed back to the SQA, and they're keen to do it. They want to say what their experiences are, and some of their experiences are not great. There are young people who have special accommodations who end up having to sit 2 exams on the same day, which means they sit 8 hours without a break. If they have an extra hour on a 3-hour exam, that ends up being that. Or they have 15 minutes between exams. They start very early or they finish very late, but it's a real... So you actually... Children who already need special accommodations are then being doubled down on the load they have. So, and they actually felt there's just no way feed back. They say it to the school, but they don't feel the school has a lot of influence. And I think that came through on some of the previous panels. So it has improved. I think in 2020, it felt very much even to us, let alone to the young people, that the SQA didn't even really see children and young people as stakeholders. They talked about the system, they communicated with the system. They spoke to schools, but they didn't speak to children and young people. That's improved. There has been more engagement directly with children and young people. They've tried some structures. I think they've fallen into the trap of trying to add children into adult structures, and we touched on that in our evidence. But there has been an attempt. So I think that there is a willingness to change in SQA. Whether this will do it, I think we very much have our doubts, and we really don't feel it's what's being proposed at the moment in terms of the lack of guaranteed influence for children and young people is in line with UNCRC.
Helpful evidence in terms of examples there, Megan, that was helpful. Garvin, are you want to?
Sure. I think it's important to think from a public standpoint, is this just a large rebranding exercise? So if you think about Facebook going to Meta or Twitter going to X, everyone still calls it by the old thing and is still understood by the old thing. So if it's the case that they're the same people in the room making the same decisions and it's got a different name and maybe a slightly longer policy, it's quite easy to see why the public would either feel disengaged or further disenfranchised. And I think that also then goes on to young people. it's important that if and when decisions are made, it's based on evidence and reason versus historicity, and we've always done this way. With that in mind, if and when there are consultations, making sure that the message is there from the start that your opinion matters as a child, as a teacher, as a head teacher, as a parent, so that we can create the good culture that we want. So what does the good culture look like? First and foremost, transparency. If and when there are questions, legitimate answers are presented. If and when mistakes happen, they are responsibly dealt with. And so I think it starts from that point so that individuals realize if and when I attain this qualification, it means something, not just to myself, but hopefully to future education, future employers, and to the wider world.
Can I ask then, does the panel think that what's proposed is enough to stop something like 2020 happening again?
I hope 2020 is something we don't see again in lots of ways, not just in terms of the effect on exams. I don't think it is, because there isn't enough attention being taken to the children and young people's rights still. It's about having them at table and listening to their views and having them influence decision-making, but it's actually also about seeing them as rights holders, about seeing education as fulfilling Article 29 as well as Article 28 of the UNCRC, about what has been talked about in terms of a move away from a concentration of exams as the final output of an education system. Most children in Scotland still don't go to university, but the vast majority stay on beyond S4, so about 14% leave at the end of S4 or before, but in total almost not quite 40% go to university, so 60% of young people are doing what are effectively university entrance qualifications in S5 and S6. I don't think there's enough being done through things like the SDA, which was a really good proposal of Professor Hayward's, to make... none of this will address that problem, I think, in terms of having a senior phase that actually, first of all, is compatible with curriculum for excellence, which is, generally speaking, a good rights-based approach, and towards meeting the needs of all of the children and young people in Scotland, so that everyone has that same right to education, whether they're going to university or not, because, as I say, the majority don't, and we need to recognise that S5 and S6 are for them too.
Thank you.
I think it's important. We need to, this committee, obviously, is looking at this bill, but you need to look at things on the round, because it is the state of education in its whole which gives confidence to examinations. So if the children can't study the subjects that they wish to, that causes issues in terms of confidence. The point actually that my colleague Megan was making some moments ago about provision for children with additional support needs to take examinations, you know, there's nothing in the bill that's going to change that, and that fundamentally is really important. And actually, if we want to avoid some of the issues of 2020, we've got to get our e-learning to a much higher and much more significant level than we have at the moment. There was a lot in Hayward, which I think would have driven some reform in this area, which would have been great for children and young people and improved public confidence. And that, unfortunately, doesn't look like it's going to make rapid progress in the next 18 months.
Thank you, Convener.
I share the view of my colleagues. I think only just building on that, when we're thinking about e-learning, making sure that students both have literacy and access to the internet is really important. I think particularly when COVID came around, it was very clear that there was the expectation, but the infrastructure wasn't there, both on the learner side and on the educator side. So making sure that there's a sort of wider framework in which people can actually be educated is important as well, and that includes special and additional needs.
Thank you, Garvin. John, can I come to you now?
Thank you. Maybe if we could start with yourself, Ms Farr, and then I've got another question that's for kind of everybody. But I just wondered, you've kind of mentioned already that, well, A, you're dissatisfied with the present system and how much children are involved and so on. But you did say there's been some improvement. Can you tell us a bit more, explain about your role in that? Have you been challenging schools? Have you been challenging SQA? You know, just how you've been involved in that.
So during 2020, and it's predominantly my colleagues in the advice and investigation team who did this work, we did a lot of work with SQA in terms of how they might change how their approach was about how they might communicate better with children and young people. We continue to engage with them on a regular basis. The Commissioner meets with the Chief Exec of SQA fairly regularly. We also supported our young advisers.
I mean, can you just give us a little flavour of that? Yeah. I mean, when you engage, you use the word engage, yeah, which can mean quite a lot of things. I mean, do you just kind of sit down and have a friendly chat, or do you really challenge them quite hard, or how does it work?
I think the hints there in the fact that it was our investigation teams and not me. I think it was quite challenging for them at times. We also, you'll be aware, did do some media comms, and the intention there was around influencing them to hear what we were saying. And we also provided the predecessor to this committee, as well as the COVID-19 committee, with evidence around what the impact of it was happening. That was an opportunity for us to play the part of our role that is supporting MSPs and their role as human rights guarantors to challenge public authorities. I did note in the SPICE briefing there was a mention of our investigation powers. We didn't use them on this occasion. There's a few reasons for that. We use them sparsely. We use them fairly strategically. When something else is happening that will have the same aim, and in this case with the SQA exams in 2020, it was already before the committee, it was already being discussed in Parliament, our involvement was to provide the rights framework to help the Education Committee, as well as Education Skills Committee, as well as in their scrutiny of SQA on those exams. We also supported children and young people to speak about how it affected them. We were informally involved with a couple of groups of young people who were working within education systems to express their views and spoke to them about how they might do that and how they might use the rights framework in order to inform it. And we also supported some of our own young advisers to appear in Parliament in 2021 to discuss the impact of the pandemic more generally, but also the impact on the exams. So there was a wide range of things that we did that was short of using our investigation powers, but were to help encourage that public scrutiny and scrutiny by Parliament of what happened in 2020 and 2021.
If the bill goes through then, mm-hmm, as it is at the moment, mm-hmm, obviously it could be amended, but I mean, will that change your relationship with Qualifications Scotland?
I think our relationship will continue to be, as I hope it would be with most public bodies, which is hopefully we are a critical friend. We will challenge them in terms of issues we come across where children's rights aren't being respected, but hopefully we, as much as we can, do it in a way that is challenging but supportive, and that's one of the other reasons why we use our formal powers.
So you're happy enough with the powers you've got? You're not looking for more powers in that relation to this? It's just kind of continuing what you've been doing?
In relation to this bill, I don't think it's something we're seeking in this bill in terms of our powers. We're not an inspectorate. We don't have a role in terms of formally checking up on a regular basis on public authorities. We're a very small office, so we try and use the staff we have as efficiently as possible as well across the whole range of our functions. So in terms of this bill, we're not looking for additional powers with regards to SQA, HMIE or any other body.
That's great. OK, thanks. Now, if I can move on to my second question, which is around the area, this whole thing about stakeholder groups, and there's obviously quite a lot of different groups here. There's these interest committees, and I think colleagues will come into that in more detail, and also the advisory bodies. But if we just take the wider term, stakeholder groups, can you say anything about your experience up till now? You've just mentioned young people being involved in the education system, but perhaps the other two witnesses. How has that been working up till now? Do you think young people's voices, you suggested that parents' voices haven't been heard very much. Is this kind of model of a stakeholder group or advisory group, is that a good model?
Yeah, it can be and it can't be. It depends on the power that that particular group has. I'll be perfectly frank with the committee. Recently, I was working with the Scottish Government and they were looking towards Connect to play a role in some of the support of those stakeholder groups. And I think there were 16 of them. I think there should be potentially fewer groups, but ones that actually listen to the people that are on them. What we would say is that, with our relationship with the Scottish Government is positive, it's very good, but I just think that sometimes that we get caught in a policy cul-de-sac, and I would just like to see a little bit less conversation and a little bit more action, please, as somebody once said.
Song, you don't want me breaking into song this week.
Mr. Seeley?
Yeah, I think it's important to realise that maybe the people that are identified as stakeholders may not have as broad and as deep a catchment as who may feel it's important to them. So I think with that in mind, understanding that it's up to individuals and groups to say, well, this is important to us, we think we have a voice here, and not the other way around, so that if and when there are concerns, they can be raised. It's not just a matter of who's in the room. Are they listened to? Is there the power to change? Many people who take the time to come and speak about these things, they don't just want to be heard. They actually want change to happen. And if and when there is a challenge to that, that's fine. I think if it's clearly identified now that there are issues, there's no need to sort of rush ahead and say, let's move ahead in sight of the problems we currently have. But how can we use this as an opportunity to modify what's here so that we can have a better Scotland today and tomorrow?
That's a lot. It suggests to me that it's a lot about ethos and attitudes and things rather than maybe what's written down in the bill. Would that be fair?
Not necessarily. I mean, I think if what's on paper here, if what's in policy doesn't reflect practice or direct, then that disconnect is going to be an issue. One of the challenges with many children and young people is they're so easy to spot hypocrisy. And so if they see a bill that doesn't include them, that's somehow about them, that's directing their futures and directing the future of the country, and they don't feel as though they've got any input or their parents don't, there's going to be that loss of confidence, and there's never going to be that productive culture that we all say we want.
Okay. Ms. Farr, you gave us a lot of information, and you referred to some of the articles, and you also talked about how you wanted young people or children to be participating, using that word. I mean, I looked at Article 12, and it talks about young people expressing their views being given due weight, and the opportunity to be heard. So it doesn't actually use the word participate. So how do we get the kind of balance in there?
Okay, so the UN Committee on the Rights of the Child issues what it's called general comments. And if you think about the UNCRC as the law, or the act of equivalent to an act of parliament, the general comments are the guidance. And they have the status of statutory guidance. And in terms of the Incorporation Act in Scotland, they're interpretive documents. So they're something that courts can use to help them understand the text of the UNCRC. And the committee issued a general comment 12. It's the only one where the numbers match up. Article 12 and general comment 12 are covered the same thing. And they made it clear that it is a right to participate, that having their views heard and given due weight is a right to participate in decision-making. It doesn't mean they make the decision. It's participating in decision-making. Professor Laura Lundy, who's an expert in both the UNCRC, but particularly in children's right to participate, has a model, and it's quite a simple one. It's a nice, easy one to remember. It's that in order to have effective participation, there needs to be space, so a space that's child-friendly, isn't dominated by adults. Children need to have the opportunity to give their voice, and that also means helping them to communicate and supporting them to communicate. In the case of a child who's involved in something formal, it means giving them some support to do so, building their capacity to represent other children's views. If a trade union has a representative on a group, they'll give that person training, they'll give them capacity, they'll give them some time to talk about what their members might want to express. We need to do the same for children. You can't just put a child into a structure. Audience, so it's who's listening to them, is the other part of her model. So is it the people who are making decisions, are they listening to them, or is it a participation worker who doesn't have the ability to feed into formal structures? So even when children aren't in the formal structure, there's a way of their views being fed into that. That allows them to participate.
Because one part of your evidence also said that young people are more comfortable, perhaps, often in a group of young people, rather than having the mix.
Absolutely. So that's where the fourth aspect of Laura Lundy's, Professor Lundy's model comes in, and that's influence. So to an extent, and I'm reflecting here as well on some of the young people I spoke to, and I won't identify them if they choose to, I'm sure they will, who were in some of the very formal structures around Scottish Government and around other education bodies during the pandemic, where they were in the room, but they really felt they didn't have a lot of influence. The room was dominated by the professionals around the room and the civil servants in the room, and they were one young person. So that thing about influence is almost the most important.
Sorry to keep interrupting you, but I mean, is influence a word we could put in legislation? Or that's quite difficult, isn't it?
No, I think it's about putting in structures, and I think what needs to be in the legislation is the structures that will, I'm searching for the right word here, that will enable that influence to actually occur.
Yep.
So it's making sure that, for example, the learner committee potentially has a majority of children and young people, certainly a majority of learners, taking into account some representation from adult learners.
And okay, I mean, I think some of my colleagues may come back into that. But
there's
that's
definitely
fine.
A lot of overlap going on there, John. I've got a few committee members that are given.
If I may convene, that question of influence is really.
It's coming up later on, Ms. Farr.
I'm about to
say there's been a bit of overlap. I'm getting a bit of pressure from other members here. But I was wondering if perhaps the other two, like Garvin and Gavin, might want to comment about how an organisation might demonstrate parents' views and other children's views are given more weight.
Yeah, I think I'll keep it really, really brief, convener. To be honest with you, there are lots of strong and well-resourced voices in the education space. Teachers' trade unions, ADES, COSLA, right? It's very, very difficult. It's an asymmetric relationship when you're a young person or you're a group of young people or you're a small parents' organisation trying to get your voice heard. And if we can do anything with legislation, let's just try and make sure that there is a balance and an opportunity for those less heard voices to be heard.
Thank you, Garvin. Gavin?
It's often the case that those with less access to the microphone are the most misrepresented and underutilized and oppressed. So it's very easy in legislation to make sure that individuals have the opportunity to speak. Anytime you're speaking and listened to, that's what participation is. It seems quite straightforward that there is the opportunity here to make things a bit more balanced so that the benefit to the students and the clear understanding that this whole exercise is happening for their benefit is there as well.
Thank you. Bill Kidnow, please.
Yep, thanks very much, convener, and thanks very much indeed to the panel for the breadth that they've given us already. But can I ask a relatively simple, but maybe not in the end result, question. What is the importance, why is it important that the bill references children specifically rather than learners? Because we know that there are other people learning other than children over the course, but why specifically should children be targeted?
I think I'm hit for that one. As you know, the Scottish Parliament has now incorporated the UNCRC into Scots law. That gives children extra rights and that recognises the particular needs of them. Children are the largest group who undertake SQA qualifications. I actually found it quite hard to find that statistic, which was interesting. They will also inevitably be the groups that are affected most by issues that come up in terms of sitting national qualifications. So the fact that they, in our view, are probably the most important stakeholder. There wouldn't be any point to SQA doing exams if there weren't children taking them. And their needs do need, and rights do need to be taken into account. It is absolutely not, as I said earlier, a failure to recognise that adult learners have important experiences to share. They've often come from, they're often sitting SQA qualifications because they've previously had a bad experience of education, for example, haven't got the qualifications in school that they might have, and there can be really important qualifications in terms of that. From our point of view, absolutely, we have a statutory obligation to consider the needs of children and it. Care experienced young people up to the age of 21, so that's who are our priorities. But children don't necessarily have to be included at the expense of adults or in adult learners or indeed parents, but they do need to be included in these processes and they do need to be included in a way that encourages them to participate actively rather than in ways that are. I think we did use the word tokenistic in our written response, and that's that model I'm thinking about where, for example, if you parachuted an S4 child and to sit next to me and give their views without any support behind them would be the kind of model, and there's a real risk that happens. And what the other thing that's really important is that there's a diversity of children's experiences and views, and sometimes when you just have the one child, they come from certain backgrounds or certain experiences. They may be very good at representing the experience of others, but they haven't experienced it themselves. So I think that support to get that diversity of children's views is really important as well. That absolutely also adult learners have a place, but the way that the bill is currently framed, there could be no children at all on the learners committee because it refers to learners rather than children and adult students or adult learners or some other term for those adults who are studying SQA. And I think the risk is that it sort of falls back into that default that works quite well of a committee sitting around a table of adults, and you either have one young person or you end up with an adult learner. The committees are also structured in such a way, for example, that although there can't be a majority, the biggest group on the committee could be SQA staff.
Thank you, Bill. As you can see, Gavin wishes to...
Very simply, obviously, from a parent's perspective, parent and carer perspective, we are the champions of our children. We are there to advocate for them and look after them. But obviously, we wouldn't be doing that with an adult learner unless that adult learner, for instance, had a learning disability, and many parents and carers act as champions for their adult children from time to time. But in the main, from a parent and carer perspective, it is the normal kind of school-aged children that are the ones that that are our focus.
Sure, thank you. Gavin, did you...
Really quickly, I think it just goes back to the about us, without us. Whether by active or passive omission, if children aren't mentioned, that creates the opportunity for loopholes and for their needs and... their concerns to be ignored.
So it's a bit of a do as I say and not do as I do type of thing. Mm-hmm. Well, thank you all very much indeed for that. Thank you.
Ross Greer, over to yourself now. Thanks.
Thanks, Convener. There's already been quite a bit of discussion about the influence or not that young people in particular can have over the structure. So I don't want to repeat too much of the ground that's already been covered. But I am interested in any suggestions that you would have for specific changes, amendments that could be made to the bill. So Megan, you've already mentioned the difference between somebody representing the interests of learners/young people and actually having a requirement that either a learner or, better yet, a young person differentiated from adult learners on the committee. Are there any other specific amendments that you would suggest making to the bill to strengthen the influence, the ability to participate for young people in particular, but also any thoughts and views that you have on adult learners and Gavin in particular, in your case, parents and carers as well?
I mean, very simply, is that either the learners' charter or that learners' committee needs to be expanded to include parents or representatives, as I said, the champions of their children, or we need a parents' charter. And I think, actually, more generally, we probably need a parents' charter for education in Scotland, is what is actually needed, but isn't really in the scope of this bill. So that would be the simple thing, is just to make sure that parents have a voice, because they are the ones that, day-to-day, are having those liaisons with schools, with local education authorities, and trying to advocate as best as they can for their kids.
There's a section where it says, qualification Scotland must consult such persons as it considers appropriate. So it's very clear that even within this bill, it's saying, here's a power imbalance, here's what we're going to do, and not, hey, what would you like, or what place do you hold? So I think the idea of specifically mentioning groups is important so that it's easier to maintain a balance, so that individuals don't feel, again, disenfranchised and, you know, unable to interact. It's not really up to the Qualifications Scotland folks to decide this is who we think is important to talk to. It should be the case that the public says, I have something to say, let's have a listen, let's have a discussion, let's move things forward.
I think that's quite a useful point, because quite understandably, we're paying a lot of attention to the committee and who's on the committee. Any representative structure like that is ultimately only going to have, at best, a handful of people from the group, probably only one in the case of young people or learners, a young person or learner. That's a point about wider participation and engagement. Megan?
I very much hope it was more than one, just because it can be a very lonely place to be on those committees. I have to say, even as an adult, it can be quite a lonely place, and some of those with the acronyms that that Gavin issued later. As mentioned earlier, obviously, in terms of of consulting with children and young people we've covered, I think in terms of HMIE. It's also possible for them to maintain their independence with some kind of legislative requirement to involve children and young people. We maintain our independence with one. There's mention in the bill around Gaelic, but there's not the equivalent for BSL, so just a change there to recognise that as also a language in which children learn. One of the other things in terms of changes to the bill is we're not entirely clear, looking at the policy memorandum and the wording of the bill, they seem to be slightly inconsistent, what the definition of educational establishment is and whether that's changing. And I think that's important in terms of making sure that all children and young people are covered. That needs to be clear what Scottish Government mean in terms of that. And just to be slightly naughty and have one that isn't on the interest committees, there's an inspection gap at present around child protection safeguarding in schools and whether or not HMI do or
that
don't
as
cover
well.
That.
If you do,
hold my fire.
Yeah.
Just one.
That's fine, Ross. I've got yourself and then Willie's.
Right, thank you. Megan, you made a point a moment ago that I think it was yourself, apologies, Gavin or Garvin, for yourselves, about the fact that SQ staff can't make up a majority on the committee, but they could make up 49% of the committee. Would you suggest amending the bill to have a lower cap on the proportion of the committee who can be staff of not SQA Qualification Scotland?
I think I'll only comment on the Learner Committee because that's really where our locus. I think some good things were said by teaching unions previously to this committee around their views on it. I think it would be possible to get the representation they need on that group and to give children and young people get to the point where children and young people, if not the majority, are able to at least be a really significant part of it, preferably the majority, with the potential for such a large proportion of them to be effectively inside the system, particularly if they're in their role as staff, as opposed to, I realise you're hearing from the staff unions at SQA later on, but I mean, I think just the structure of how these groups work is if you have a large number of people who are from the organisation's needs start to come first. So, yes, I would prefer to see the number of Qualification Scotland staff reduced.
Thanks very much. Unless anybody else got anything to add, that's all from me.
Anything else I would add is potentially, it's never a good idea to have, you know, what I was talking about before, those kind of asymmetric organisations. If you look at I know it's a massive segue, you look at IJBs, so you've got 8 non-executive directors and you've got 8 councillors. Do you think the councillors are going to agree with each other? No, of course they're not. So you end up with this kind of these processes where policy is enacted and then moved through, sometimes with actually scant debate. And this is too important. So that's not set up to fail in the first place, and make sure that all of the players that are part of that committee actually, you know, really have to engage with the issues to come to some consensus.
Willie Rennie?
This is the devil's advocate question. Is this not getting a bit too much? I mean, every representative we've got coming before us today is arguing for more than one space on all these different committees. We will end up with a massive organisation that's completely unwieldy, will we not? How do we... I mean, I think Megan's actually solution, perhaps of almost a separate structure for children in order to make sure that they're listened to in a different forum, might be the way of doing this. But to lead an organisation with everybody having the absolute representation that they think they deserve, surely this is not all a bit too much.
It's an argument, isn't it? I mean, you could say that you've got 129 MSPs, and that's quite a lot, isn't it? And some people would like a lot more. But Willie, I think you actually make an opposite point. The last thing we want for children is stasis, because actually children have waited long enough. Yeah, every time that there is another, like Hayward gets stuck in the bottom drawer for 16 months, it's children that pay the price for that, actually. Let's not remember this. We're only at school for a very, very short period of time. So the last thing we want is organised sort of stasis. And I think it's much more about, if you like, ethos and leadership, is whether people actually get heard or not. It's not a money and numbers game, you know? And the problem is for you guys is it's really difficult to legislate for ethos and leadership, but that's probably what we need.
Briefly, Megan?
I think just follows up on that thing about putting children into adult structures. That's almost part of the problem, is that we're trying to kind of put these groups into adult structures rather than thinking about structures from, apologies, I forget who it was, a previous session who talked about from the bottom up. It's like, so how do we feed these in? And that's about, as Gavin said, it's about the ethos of the people who are making the decisions, but also making them on the basis of all of that information, and also on the basis of having done a child's rights impact assessment and a quality impact assessment and all of that. So the Learner Committee is a really good change in that it acknowledges learners as one of, well, it's probably the most important stakeholder for the SQA. But it's an adult structure which they're trying to put children into. And I think that could be definitely developed into something further, and that might make the process slightly less top-heavy. It's quite a big process already. I remember being quite shocked at how many staff the SQA have. It's a really big organisation. I think it was 80 times as big as ours. There's already a lot of noise in there, and there are very good cases to make, but I think I would remind the committee that children and young people are the ones sitting the exams predominantly, and without them the exams wouldn't be happening, so I would very much plea that any rationalisation cannot happen at the expense of children and young people's participation.
Thanks. George Adam now, please. Thank you, George.
We had the teaching unions just following on from Willie's question in last week, and they've got a solution. Their solution is quite simple. Take every one of you out of the equation and just put them there. Because they're the ones that have got all the answers. They know what learners want. They know how the system works. And they think that they're the ones that can do all that. And they think that's a simplification of the whole process, rather than have this MGM 1940s chorus line kind of musical idea of a committee. So what are your thoughts on that?
Again, it comes back to the idea of like asymmetric relationships. I represent an organisation with about, 9 staff, an annual turnover of less than £1 million. I don't think we could pay the EIS's lunch money, to be honest with you. But the thing is, what I do represent is a lot of parents. And the thing is, when we think about, when we think about things, for every child learner, on average, there's kind of about 1.5 parents. Parents are a massive constituency. They will decide who wins the next election. Mm-hmm. Be very aware of that. And they deserve to be heard. Because, again, they come to the point. They're the ones that have to advocate for their children to make sure they're heard. And unfortunately, at the moment, for a lot of children, it's not working as well as we want. Every day, I get phone calls from parents across Scotland saying, my child's they didn't have a class teacher this morning. They're now in a class of 90 in the dinner hall filling out worksheets. That's not education. That's not, to draw out. That's not teaching and learning. That's childminding, and it's unacceptable. Another school, I got a horrific phone call that I had last week from a parent whose child sat in a dinner hall in a different school for 6 months and didn't go to class because they weren't getting the ASN support that they had. So if we don't believe that parents deserve a voice when they are the champions of their children, frankly, we're getting it horrifically wrong. And I would say to my colleagues in the EIS, and other teaching unions are available, we want to work in partnership with teachers. We see the value of teachers. Education doesn't work without great teaching and great leadership. We are your supporters. Please see us as valuable allies.
Yeah, I think building on that, we are here to work together. I think your question quite builds on what Rennie said. Willie Rennie said, the devil doesn't need an advocate. I don't think the concern should ever be, is this too complicated to do the right thing? And the truth is, it's not, because the right thing is important enough that it's worth taking the time and effort to get it right. When I was in a high school yesterday, visiting with students and teachers, I said, growing up in the US predominantly, what's the point of education here? Like, why are you teaching these kids? Is the goal to pass the tests or to educate? The resounding answer from the majority of people I interacted with was to pass tests. And so I think even understanding what's happening here and what's the purpose of this, is really important to discuss so that students don't feel like a pawn in someone's larger system, but they know that they're there for their benefit and not for the accolades of a school or for the glory of their parents or something like that. So I think working in partnership is certainly possible so that we can, again, make a better future for our young people.
Megan?
I think my shortest answer would be, well, they have a right, children have a right to participate in decision. We passed a law that said that twice now. But finally, last year, the slightly longer version is that children and young people have their experience of the exams as they happen. Their experience of exams is different from that of their teachers. And although they may share them with their teachers, there's a level of filter, and they have the right to be directly tell Qualification Scotland and their schools how they experience their exams and feed that in and be listened to and given due weight. They also are one of the great sources of innovation. They are ready for the world as it is now. They're aware of what's going on in the world, and they will come up with fantastic ideas about how to make education in Scotland more ready for the 21st century. They have a lot to contribute. They say some really great things that adults don't always think about. They are thoughtful and creative, and we have empowered them. The children who sat National Fives this year will be voting in 2026. You know, they are also your constituents. They have a lot to contribute, so that's the really important reason for them to be part of it. They have a different perspective from teachers. They don't carry the baggage of how it's been for 10 years, 15 years, 30 years since we sat our exams. They know what it's like to sit the exams now as a student rather than supervise them as a teacher or teach to them as a teacher. So it's a different perspective, and it's a really, really important one. And that's not to say that education staff, and I say education staff because it's also college lecturers, deliver SQA exams, and they're really important too, don't also have an important part to play. And I think that's one of the reasons, the benefits of the way that it's been set up in terms of the learner committee and the practitioner committee, is it does demonstrate the need for that balance.
Just to expand on the fact that one of the most important aspects as a parent, as a grandparent now, you know, is the fact of you want the best for your children, you know. So when I was quite struck, I may have kind of over-egged my initial question a bit, but I was quite struck at educational professionals coming in and saying, you know, that, you know, they were the ones that knew. Their exact quote was, teacher voice will represent, be cognizant of the interests of learners. You know, that was the actual quote. And to me, I'm more on your side because take the political element that Gavin brought up out of it, which is, for us, important, you know, but at the end of the day, parents just want what's best for children, and children want to actually be valued and engaged in the process. So, you know, still with that massive kind of amount of people, stakeholders, how do we get it to be constructive? How do we get it so that everybody feels they're getting something out of it?
What I would say, I think, is actually, we need to remember as well, not all teachers are the same, and not all teachers necessarily will believe everything about pedagogy that the union believe, for instance. You know, there are different opinions. And also what I'd say is a lot of teachers are parents as well. They've got multiple hats on. I mean, I spoke to a teacher very recently as part of my role, and he's very disappointed with the qualification system. He's an English teacher. He's teaching The Crucible, one of the greatest works of American literature, a beautiful piece of writing. And he's teaching his students how to pass their Nat 5, right? Or pass their higher in this case. And they have to go through this convoluted process of writing essays, which are not in normal narrative prose, but a series of substandards that will be easily be able to be marked so that you get your higher. Mm. What has our education system become where an educationalist that loves brilliant literature, right, has seen it, as he put it to me, it sucked the fun out of it, okay? So I think sometimes educationalists in terms of, you know, the trade unions or others will have a view, and they're entitled to that view, and that's great. But many individual teachers may have a different view about the future that they want to see for an exam system.
Anyone else wanting to comment on that before I move on?
Just really quickly, I think what Gavin said is completely correct, and I think the challenge that a lot of teachers face is if they voice their opinions, they're always, of course, concerned about job security and the ability to further their career. So it may be the case that they're not as free to advocate on behalf of students, depending on the structures within their institutions.
That's great. And Liam Kerr?
Yeah, thanks, Convener. Good morning, panel. Just a brief question arising from something that Willie Rennie posed to you earlier on. I thought Willie Rennie's point about how many people could potentially, or how many groups could potentially end up on committees was an interesting one. And it just begs a question, which I'll throw to Megan first and then move along. Do you think that there's a solution whereby you legislate, i.e. amend this bill, to create a duty to set up processes such that particular groups are heard, rather than incorporating them onto various committees?
I think the solution in terms of this bill is probably a mix of both, of incorporation ways. We have legislation that talks about children's views in ways that suit the children, putting that structure together. Part 1 of the Children Scotland Act 2020 is a really good example of legislating not just for children's views to be heard, but for them to be heard in a way in which the child prefers. So I think it is possible. I think it probably will need a bit of thought, and that will include from us as well from others, particularly if amendments to change the learner committee from its current status. I think there is, though, scope to leave some of it for in terms of policy and framework, in terms of setting up, but it needs a commitment. And I think to support the bill, we'd need a commitment from government that there was going to be the resource to put that broader participation structure into the successor for SQA, particularly, also to HMIE, also to the replacement for Education Scotland. But I think in terms of the formal structures, there does need to be legislation to ensure that children and young people are included in those structures.
Thank you. Gavin?
Because otherwise they may not be.
I think it's much more about the political dynamic, which is more important, right? What you don't want to have, in my opinion, would be a situation where there was a dominant prevailing voice that just could bulldozer anything through. There needs to be dissonant voices to be heard. Now, the structure of that, I think that's a matter for, actually, you know, you guys are fantastic at these kind of things. You invent these structures and processes along with your civil servants, and I think that's a good thing. What I would say, though, is if there is a role for teachers on any committee, I would like to see a role for parents, because I just think that sometimes we need to make sure that we have a balance and a bit of equity.
Because on that, forgive me, Garvin, I will come to you with that same question, but on that, the bill specifically doesn't mention parents when it comes to the learner committees. You'd presumably want that amended explicitly.
There is a minor mention. I would like it absolutely on the face of the bill to make it absolutely clear, not just for, you know, for this iteration of this, but going forward as well, to make sure that parents and carers always have their voices listened to. And that, by the way, doesn't need to be my organisation. I really, you know, that doesn't bother me in the slightest, right? There are other ways of doing this. Recently, a week ago, I set up the Scottish Assembly of Parents and Carers, which is a lived experience panel. We've got 250 applicants to that last night. We will be going forward with work with at least 100 of those, with its members coming from everywhere, from up in Shetland down to Stranraer and above. So what we're trying to do with this is trying to get all of these voices of parents and try and synthesise them as much as possible. So the structure is less important than making sure that, if you like, the political dynamic, and I don't mean that political with meaning party political, but the political dynamic is at least in some way balanced.
Thank you. Garvin?
Yeah, I think with that in mind, where does the spirit and the letter of the law deviate? So if you don't specifically legislate when you have the opportunity to, that again creates the potential for loopholes. So if we understand that parents are important, that children are important, why would we not want to specifically include them? It seems like a very easy, straightforward opportunity to make a brilliant change for the positive.
Grateful to you all. Megan, you want to come back in?
If I could come in very briefly, Convener. Just to be clear, that we would have no problem with parents being involved as well. They are the champion of their children's rights. They're an important champion of children's rights. Our calls are not incompatible. I think they're complementary.
Super. Thank you very much. Willie Rennie now, we're moving on to a different angle.
This is about inspections. So I've got three aspects. The first is, the union last week expressed the desire to change the way that inspection works. So that it's more about improvement as much as it is about simply crude inspection. Do you have a view on that?
From a parent's point of view, I mentioned this in my opening remarks. Why do we have inspections? It's about public confidence. That's what it is, right? Is that school doing everything it should be doing to make sure that there is good learning and teaching going on, that the rights of children are being respected, and that the rights of parents are being respected, under the 2006 Act, to make sure that they've got an involvement in their school. And that's the most important thing. Secondly, yes, it should be about continual improvement. There's no point in just coming into a school and saying that it's this or that or the other. Some of that is important, but I think what most parents want to see is if there are issues in a school, that they are seen, that they are identified and they are addressed, right? That is the crucial thing about inspections. But as part of that, the inspection needs to be, I think, sometimes that it involves a kind of much more whole school approach. So it's not just examining what's going on in the classroom or in the corridors, but it's what's happening in the community as well. And parents are a part of that, and they're a really key part of that. Because where parents are involved, we know that children actually do better. And crucially at the moment, what happens, inspectors do, I think, a really, really decent job, but their involvement with parents is almost scant. And actually, if you want to get into the nitty-gritty of what's actually going on at a school, speak to the mums and dads, because they know, OK? At the moment, there is an inspection going on, but the inspectorate are doing a thematic of all local authorities in Scotland. We welcome that. It's good. As part of that, they'll be looking at some of the parental involvement. Fantastic. And on my suggestion, I said, speak to the parent council chairs. They're a really important group. They're volunteers. They're wonderful. Speak to them. I think they'll get an hour, maybe. And they might get an hour with a lay inspector. Now, got nothing wrong with lay inspectors, fantastic people, but we need a deeper involvement. And more than that, there needs to be a way for parents who have got concerns about their school to be able to contact the inspectorate directly. Not to kind of have a sudden whistle-blowing tour that they come in and rip a school to pieces, but if there is a pattern of concern about an education establishment, surely the inspectorate would want to be cognisant of that, right? And it should inform their inspection routine going forward.
Megan?
I think there were a lot of really reassuring things said in the evidence session you had from HMAE, from Ms McManus the other week, around looking at different models and methodologies and what would work best. I think that kind of the sort of short notice, one-hit inspections have a really significant impact on teaching staff and on the schools, and inevitably that will also have an impact on the child. I think there's probably some benefit moving away from that into a more collaborative model that involves the whole school community, and Gavin makes a really good point about parents but also children. Yeah. I'm sure it's a really diverse range of children who have different experiences of the school, particularly in secondary school. It's not the pupil council necessarily, they have a role, but also a wide range of children, not necessarily ones picked by the school. I think there's also potential to explore ways in which children can be involved, not just as respondents to an inspection, but potentially as part of the inspection team. Care Inspector have done some work around this. Their group's slightly older, but not a lot older, around having children asking some of the questions as well as and informing what the questions are, as well as answering them. So I think there's lots of opportunity there, and I got the impression there's a real willingness to explore that within HMIE, which was really positive. I did touch on this earlier, and I hope, convener, this is the right time to bring it in. We have been made aware recently in terms of, I think there's been a petition to the Parliament around, as well, about a potential gap around child protection and safeguarding and who inspects that in schools. And it may be that it It's not clear. I think this would be an opportunity to make that absolutely clear as well. It's a really, really important function that we need to be sure is happening. And it's been well rehearsed, I know, around Petitions Committee and other places, but I think it is worth raising in this context.
I think you're right. I've been involved with the GTCS and others who've expressed concerns that there's nobody looking at that from the whole, from the local authority perspective, who's checking their processes. And obviously the GTCS is not really qualified as representatives of individual members. So I think that's right, there is a gap, and I hope that this is able to address it. So I think that's right. Gavin?
Yeah, I think in general my thoughts on inspections are, does everyone know that it's happening? So let's perform and look busy. Let's make sure we put the happy, positive people forward, as opposed to an actual, authentic, what's happening here? What can we do better? It should always be the case that you know, you're there for the purpose, again, of the young people. I think my colleagues are right. Children and parents do have a role in inspection. It's important not only to sort of investigate best practice, but also to share it, so that if and when schools are stellar, they can pass that on to places that maybe don't have the resources or the legacies of others. If and when there are patterns of concern that develop in an area, make sure that they're investigated, so that individuals can speak openly and authentically about culture, so that teachers aren't afraid of reparations that may occur because they've mentioned issues of concern. I think also making sure that processes are anonymized, so that if and when children do have concerns, they know that there aren't going to be those sorts of repercussions that will affect their grades and their future standing.
Okay. So you've talked about, quite naturally, about involvement. I was trying to tease out of you whether there was any tension with the desire of the trade unions to change the method of inspection. Because what you want is an understanding. If there's a problem, it's getting dealt with. Mm-hmm. Is there a tension between you and the unions on that, do you think?
From a parent's perspective, the problem is that parents are not, I've said this again, a homogenous group. Some will like a much more robust, go and get in there and get it sorted. But I think they are in the minority. And the surveys that we've done in the past, I think there is an accommodation that can be made with the views of the trade unions to have inspections which are about continual improvement rather than just marking, giving them a mark and moving on. What's absolutely clear about any inspection system, though, is when problems are identified, what parents are expecting is, to come back and come back and come back until matters are fixed. And I would hope that our colleagues in the from teachers' trade unions would see that as a sensible and a sensible method to move towards that kind of continual improvement methodology.
So the final aspect then is, how is that communicated to parents? Because not every parent will be actively engaged in the detail of every part of the school. So how is it communicated so that it's clear, but also protects the institution from being overly criticised without the degree, the depth of knowledge? How do we make sure that balance is kept?
Well, I mean, we've surveyed on this in the past, and there needs to be better communication between schools and parents and local authorities and parents as well. So whenever there is an inspection period, there needs to be early communication with parents so they understand what the purposes of the inspection is, how it's going to be carried out, and how parents can properly get involved. And I would suggest it needs to be a lot deeper than the current methodologies, which tends to be, here's a form, fill it out, thank you very much. Do you agree strongly that this school is good? And I've seen some shocking experience of parent-wise surveys, which seem to be quite long and quite unwieldy to fill in, but don't actually get down to the granular detail that we're really interested in, which is, where are there levels of improvement that could happen? Where are there levels of underperformance? I think that actually the same concerns that parents have will be the same concerns that teachers have. We all want better schools. We all want better quality of teaching and learning. We all want the same thing. But to communicate with parents, you have to do it in a multiplicity of ways. It can't just be a group call or an email, right? Head teachers need to take huge responsibility and actually have that involvement with their school community.
Okay. Very good.
Thank you. Certainly our position is incompatible with that of the teachers. I think actually we probably have a lot of common ground in terms of the high stake inspection. We certainly wouldn't want to see the sort of thing that's happened in England where it's been single word things, and also the level of stress that's put on a school with an inspection. I think there still is some of that in Scotland, maybe not to the same extent, but the point of inspection is to make sure that every child in Scotland is getting an education that meets the requirements of their right to education in terms of the UNCRC, and that's to develop their personality, talents, mental and physical abilities to their highest potential, to their fullest potential. That's what an inspection should be geared at looking at, and is it doing it for all of the children in all of the schools? Is the education a child receives in a small secondary school in a rural or island community the same as the education that a child will have if they're growing up in the centre of Edinburgh or Glasgow with the choices that are available in there? It shouldn't be about, is this school better than the other? It is about how can the school improve so that they better realise children's right to an education. In terms of communication, it needs to be communicated with the children as well as with the parents, and potentially needs to be done by HMIE, not the school. It's sort of back to the same thing issue in terms of SQIA, about everything being done via the school. There's probably something in an HMIE coming along to communicate directly with children and tell them what they found at their school. You know, your school is a really good school, you're all clearly very happy here, we thought that this could be done better. That sort of communication on children's level is also their right. So that's something we'd like to see as well. But I don't think any of that is incompatible with some of the calls that were being made in terms of teachers. I think one of the really interesting things about this entire bill is I don't think I've ever been involved in a bill where so many of the witnesses that give evidence to committee agree with each other on almost everything. It's been quite a surprise.
Yeah, okay. Lovely.
It was good.
Well, that being said, I concur. I think in general, what's the making sure that parents, teachers and learners are aware, what's the purpose of the inspection? You know, so honestly, why is it happening? Have concerns been raised? Is this just the regular part of a rotation? What's being explored, who will be consulted, and how will the results be communicated transparently? So I think all of those things are for everyone's benefit, and so it should be an open, easy, and hopefully not too challenging process for everyone involved. I think one of the particular reasons you want to communicate to children that something is happening is they always know when disquiet is occurring. They can sense that teachers are a bit flummoxed. And so I think making sure that there's the understanding, this is what's going on. You've done nothing wrong. You know, similarly, if you see parents fighting, you know, it's easy for children to start to believe it's their fault and something's gone wrong. Okay, no, we're just making sure we're getting the best education for you guys, and so some people are coming in. And I think these things can be communicated to different groups in a way that makes it as painless and professional as possible.
That's helpful. Thank you for that. Jackie Dunbar, please.
And just following on from that, I would also say, as a former parent council member and local councillor, I know how things can be looked on differently when inspections happen. Sometimes people are so busy trying to tick the boxes, they forget what it's actually about. If I can move on to the equality issue. In regards to the current national agencies and the support that they give, how well do you think that support helps the diversity of learners who have got protected characteristics? Is there enough support in place, I would say? Megan?
I won't completely recover everything we covered in the ASN inquiry. I think that is all really well recognised, and committee's report was picked up on the really wide range of concerns everyone has around that. But I think we're sort of back to that statistic I mentioned earlier, where we need to recognise that who stays at school is different from what it was 30 years ago, 40 years ago. Children stay on beyond S4 almost routinely. It's a really low percentage you don't now, and we need a senior phase that isn't geared towards preparing children just for university. At the moment we've got qualifications that effectively funnel that way, and we don't have the same support for different routes out of education into
like trades.
To trades, to apprenticeships, to college courses rather than university, that's improving. To young people who choose to go out and work, and maybe they'll work for a couple of years but and go on to something else after. Is that kind of linear thing that certainly when I was at school 30 years ago, it was you finished school, you went to university, and that was if you were in the final year of school, you were all the ones who were only going to university. Every single one of us did. That's not the case now. S6 now, children, you know, there'll be children going to all sorts of different destinations. We need an education system that recognises that, and that will also go some way to recognising the needs of children with different protected characteristics. This particular issue around disabled children and those of them who might need to take a different route into work or further education, or those who just might need more time to do so. We had a system that was supposed to allow more flexibility in terms of what qualifications you took in which year. We've slipped back into the rigidity of S4 as NAT5s, S5 as hires. S6 sometimes ends up being some more random hires that you haven't studied before. So we've got a real problem with the senior phase that is sort of still working on a system of what school was like 40 years ago, what people's destinations were like 40 years ago, when many, many people left at the end of S4. It's great that people are staying on, but it's not necessarily qualifications or pathways that are given the same level of esteem in the education system for all of those children, and they absolutely have to be, because otherwise we're failing to meet that really large group of children's right to an education.
Okay. The greatest concern that parents have when they come to us in surveys, and the recent Scottish Assembly recruitment is ASN and ASL. It's the biggest by far, and it's the thing that exercises parents so greatly, and that's why so many parents that have got children with additional support needs join parent councils to try and improve things in their schools. They give their volunteer time to try and improve that, and sometimes they feel that they're kind of hitting a bit of a brick wall. It's a fight that kind of goes on every day. This is a wider, much wider issue than just this bill. But currently, you know, what we'd say is that it's probably the greatest issue that affects Scottish education.
Gavin, do you have anything to add?
Yeah, sure. I mean, everyone in this room has protected characteristics in relation to your question, and I think it's important to realise that, but the challenge occurs when individuals are discriminated against, and these things can then become additional obstacles in the educational journey. So I think making sure that teachers have access to the support that they need, whether from a sort of government and legislation standpoint, whether from a charity standpoint, making sure that they're aware that things are in place so that if and when things occur in the classroom or even outside the classroom on school grounds, that you have the resources to do. If you don't have the resources, where do you go and what's available? And so there's a lot of brilliant people in Scotland trying to educate children and involved in the whole infrastructure, and I think a lot of it could be benefited by individuals getting to know each other, different organizations working together, and being clear, high school, we're here to help you. What do you need? So if I get a call from primary school in Fife that they're facing challenges, I'm there. What do you need? You know, they know everything's confidential. They know we're there to help. Okay, great. Let's put you on to all the other organizations that can help you as well. So I think it's that partnership working that can help eradicate some of these challenges, but I think also making it very clear, again, you're in school to train your brain to learn so that by the time you get to something you're really interested in, you can grasp it quickly. But we're also here to make sure that we have great global citizens, because we're just a tiny island in the Atlantic that's not really as important as it used to be. So with that in mind, people are traveling abroad and people are coming in. What is it like to deal with the world, and how do you interact with others that may be different? Maybe they have a different characteristic. And I think making it clear to children that you start with that decency and you start with that authenticity, from that standpoint that you see individuals and not the characteristics first, can make it easier for them to then want to interact and realize again that they're there to learn and everything else is secondary.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. I've got a specific supplementary from Pam Duncan Clancy.
Thank you, Convener. It was really just to specifically pick up on the points around BSL and inclusive communication in the bill. Are there areas where you think the bill could be strengthened in that sense?
With permission, Convener, we will share those with the committee in writing. I don't have the full detail here.
Thank you, that's helpful. Gavin, any comments on that?
Our approach has always been to be as inclusive as possible. Okay. We mentioned particularly Gaelic in our response. I think it was remiss of us not to mention BSL more exactly. And if we could correct the record, we would do.
Well, you've done that verbally. So
thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Garvin.
Yeah, I concur with my colleagues. There is no mention of British Sign Language or BSL within the document, and here's a great opportunity to change that.
Thank you very much. That's super. Thank you very much, everyone. And thank you, the panel, for your evidence this morning. We're going to suspend the meeting for 20 minutes, yes, to allow the witnesses to leave and for our second panel to come in. All right. Thank you very much. Welcome back, and can I welcome our second set of witnesses this morning? We've got Ken McCarra, HM Inspector of Education and Convener of the FDA Education Scotland Section, FDA. Sharon McGuigan, SQA Accreditation Manager and Workplace Representative from Unite the Union, morning. And Pauline Roger, SQA Understanding Standards Project Manager and Workplace Representative from Unite the Union. Thank you all for joining us this morning. And as with our first panel, we're going to go straight to questions from members. And kicking us off is Willie Rennie.
So I want to get to the heart of the question about culture and the criticism that exists of the SQA and that its inability to listen, to engage, to participate. What's your view of that?
You want to start with us?
Yep, can do. Yep.
Our view in terms of culture, external facing culture, is that there obviously always is room for improvement in relation to how we work with teachers, lecturers, employers, and a whole range of other organisations. But it's also true, and it has to be recognised, that currently staff in their day-to-day jobs work extremely well and effectively with a wide range of partners and stakeholders when they're undertaking their day-to-day job. And I think at staff level, certainly, that has been how we actually carry out our jobs and carry out our roles effectively, is to have that partnership working and that listening attitude to the work that we do, whether it's in the development of national qualifications or HN qualifications, or whether it's in the regulation and accreditation sphere, we do have to work with a wide range of partners, across, not just in Scotland, but across the UK and internationally. So the culture in terms of how we work with stakeholders and partners, we believe on a day-to-day basis, is pretty effective, and customer service surveys would evidence that. However, you know, Unite does believe very strongly that the decision-making process has to be democratic and collaborative, and that's the sphere where we think we could do much better. And you know, we have to ensure that those that we do work with, you know, feel and are being worked with in terms of decision making, that their views are.
Okay, so it sounds like you think the criticism is unfair.
I think the criticism is unfair of staff, certainly. I think that staff who work in qualifications development, who work in accreditation and regulation and operations and a whole range of other parts of the organisation work
So why is there such strong criticism, though? There must be something in it.
Could I just add to that? I think what we're talking about here, we're here as representatives of staff at SQA, and we're here to reflect their experience and their views. A lot of the criticism that has been levelled at SQA has been levelled at it as an institution, how it relates to other strategic institutions within the education system. So, for example, we were listening to ADES, School Leaders Scotland, the unions, the teaching unions. And it's for those organisations to speak to and give evidence on their experience of working with SQA. The day-to-day work that we do is at an operational, practical level. And our experience of working with teachers, so for example, we, and I think both School Leaders Scotland and ADES attested to this, in all our qualifications developments, it is subject specialists we work with and who help us to shape those qualifications. And those would be practising subject specialists. In the setting of exams, we have principal assessors, and deputy principal assessors. In the setting of assessments for internal assessment, we have principal verifiers. They are all practising teachers, and they will also work with other teachers across a variety of different schools in coming up with valid and reliable assessments. So I think what we're seeing is that's the day-to-day experience. And if you were to, for example, speak to the people who've been on our development groups who've worked on qualifications, if you were to speak to the people who work on developing exams, on developing and on running marking, I think you would get a different individual experience from these people. But obviously a lot of the criticism and a lot of the evidence that has come so far has been at a strategic high-level organisational level. And as I say, that is for those organisations to speak to. And if they do not feel the culture in terms of how the organisation as a whole relates to them, then that's their evidence, yeah.
So it's the leadership, not the staff?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay. Ken?
Well, we didn't make any submission as far as SQA was concerned at all. I'm here to represent members in Education Scotland, so it would not be appropriate for me to talk about culture within SQA.
Okay, that's fair enough. Yeah, fair enough. Okay, so the second law, how is the relationship between those who are appointees to support national qualifications and existing staff? How is that relationship managed? Is that quite a good one?
It is, and it has to be, because we could not do what we do, as the staff at the organisation could not do what they do without the advice and the input of these subject specialists. So it might help to kind of illustrate. So if we take any qualifications team, you have a qualifications manager, you've got qualifications officers. They are responsible for managing either qualification development, the development of an individual qualification, or the development of the exams or internal assessment for that year. They have regular meetings, they have discussion. There's a whole process that you go through that also involves other teachers to make sure that what comes out, the subject specialists are happy with. None of that would work unless those relationships were good. And obviously, the subject specialists are key to ensuring that the content of a qualification or the coverage of a question paper or an internal assessment is actually valid in terms of the subject that they teach. That's not the job of the qualifications officers and the qualifications managers. Their job is to make sure that it's valid and reliable in terms of a credible assessment.
So there's no tensions between those two groups?
Not on a day-to-day working basis. That doesn't mean to say, obviously, tensions cannot arise in individual circumstances. So I came into the organisation, it might be helpful to illustrate, from teaching. I was a philosophy and religious studies teacher, and I came in on secondment when there was the review of Higher Still. So I came in as a development officer, and my focus was on subject. And we got together a development group, which had teachers of those subjects from across the country, who had different experiences, were delivering in different centres. And there has to be robust discussion, because as a teacher, and I'm not sure if there's anybody here who has been a teacher, but as a teacher, you have to have a view of the subject. You have to have a view of how best to deliver that to the young people. You might be working in a particular context in a particular school, whereas another colleague on that development group might be working in a completely different context and have a very different view of how philosophy should be taught. So there has to be robust discussion. But the job of the qualifications teams in that is to come to a conclusion and to have a qualification or an assessment that everybody can put their hands up to and say, right, my view's been heard. I know why we've not gone with this one, but I do know why we've gone with that one, and that everybody's comfortable with. So that's the... you can't say nobody ever disagrees. Of course they do, but you have to come for the sake of the learners. At the end of the day, everybody's got to come to an agreement. And when it works well, and it works well, certainly I've had great experiences working with people. Not everybody gets everything in that qualification that they want to get in a qualification. But at the end of the process, what we want people to feel is their voice has been heard. If everything hasn't been taken on board for reasons of validity, reliability and credibility in the qualification system, at least everybody understands why that is the case.
So go back to my first point and your last comment, which you agreed with. It's the leadership, not the staff. Do you think the leadership of the SQA should become and remain as the leadership of the new Qualification Scotland?
Very interesting question, Mr. Rennie. Particularly...
Sounds like you're going to dodge it.
Of, we never dodge questions. Particularly of two trade union reps. Because as trade unionists, we're in the business of protecting people's jobs. We're in the business of enhancing people's jobs.
Yeah.
So I'm going to give you a very truthful answer to that initially, and then I'm going to expand on it if you don't mind, but you can obviously stop me if I'm going off on another track.
Yeah. Okay.
We will. So the truth of the matter is we're obviously here to represent our members. It's not our voices, it's not any individual voice within SQA, or indeed it's not the organisation's voice, it's the voice of our members. And the truth of the matter is we have not surveyed our members on that question. We would not dream of giving out an answer to that question without having thoroughly surveyed our members. That being said...
Why haven't you asked?
Well, we haven't asked because we've not been asked to ask.
So will you ask me?
It's good to ask.
I'm dodging that question there. Obviously, we respond to the wishes of our members. And I hope you appreciate that.
But there's leadership too, isn't there? I mean, you're leaders of your union. Surely
we are representatives of our members.
Yeah, but you do provide leadership too. And you listen to what people say.
Yes.
And you don't always wait to survey members before you express a view.
If I come on to the survey bit, I mean, what kind of question would we be asking? And we have a code of conduct. We are subject to a code of conduct within the organisation. And while we are sitting here, we are still subject to that code of conduct. And the question that we would have to ask members would be around the confidence in the leadership of the organisation. And that would be quite a question to ask. And it would... And, you know, we have a good idea of what our members think around that subject without having to go to a vote on it. We have had many conversations with our membership over the months, years, particularly since the announcement that we were being replaced. And there's a variety of views, but I would say that many of our members believe that it would be difficult to see a change in culture within the new organisation if those leaders within the current organisation transfer to that new organisation. We would need to see demonstration internally and more important, because we say we're trade unionists, we're a democratic organisation. You know, and we would need to see a demonstration from leadership that there has been a change in that culture, that our members would feel more listened to, that they're also involved in any decision making. that there's meaningful consultation within the organisation in relation to a whole range of policies and procedures, etc., that impact on our members. That's been difficult. We have had, and we have pushed, pushed to be here today. I mean, first of all, we'd like to thank the committee to allow us to be here today to have our staff voice heard. It's certainly a first in this committee. And I think, you know, we have had to push quite hard for our members' voices to be heard because they haven't been. And that's the culture. Staff voice is not being heard.
Yeah. You have answered it, so I'm grateful for that. It sounds like, unless those changes happen, you think the leadership should go.
Can I just say, it's not about what we think. We're here to represent our members. Okay. Our members come from across all areas in the SQA, and our members will have varying opinions depending on their own experience within the part of the organisation they work with. So I would, so please don't take that as being the answer.
I thought that's what it was.
I think it's legitimate. We have heard evidence from other organisations and representatives who have been in front of this committee who have made it very clear that they do not believe that the same leadership could go into the new organisation. And, you know, we have sympathy with that view, and it is their view, and it's a legitimate view.
Okay. I'm Duncan Glancy. I know there was a little bit of overlap, a little bit, but can you pick up on that thread? Thanks.
I absolutely can. Thank you very much, Convener. Good morning. Thank you to all of you. And I just want to say up front that I acknowledge how difficult this is and the conversation that we're having, and I thank you for coming this morning. I really appreciate it. I'm sure other members do as well, because the importance of staff voice in this is crucial. To go, I guess, a step further, and we've touched on the point about leadership. I asked the Scottish Government in a written question its position on whether or not there should be a reserved space on the new Board of Qualifications Scotland for trade union representation, in addition to staff representation. And they said the Government's position is, in the bill, that the Board would consist of one or more members who have knowledge in the interests of staff of Qualifications Scotland. So could I ask Pauline and Sharon, forgive me, Ken, on the basis of what you said earlier, how well do you think the current arrangements where a staff representative is on the board of SQA ensure the voice of the staff body is heard? And what are your views on the proposed arrangements and the government's response to the question?
Okay, well, there's a very straightforward and simple answer to the first part of that question. Staff members do not feel that the arrangements as they currently are work. We have, and the arrangements in terms of staff representation on the board that are currently in place are identical to the arrangements that are being suggested in the Board of Qualifications Scotland. So we have a representative on the board who has knowledge of the interests, who's there to, because they have knowledge of the interests of staff. But that member of the board does not engage with staff, does not take feedback from staff. Therefore, they have a very scant knowledge and potentially knowledge of the interests of staff at a very theoretical and experiential level. We believe that there has to be a staff representative, at least one, on the board. And that staff representative needs to be elected by the staff to sit on the board. We also believe there should be trade union representation on the board, because obviously the trade unions are the legitimate voice of staff. And there was an interesting response to a question, I think it was from the Assistant Secretary of the EIS, when talking about teacher representation on the board. And I thought she made a very, very good point. It's not enough to have someone on the board who is or has been a teacher, for example. the person or persons on the board, in her words, have to be representative of the teaching profession, not there to represent their own views. And we would have exactly the same view as to having a staff representative or representatives on the board. As I say, Unite's position would be we need an elected representative from the staff, and we need to have trade union representation because the trade unions represent staff who are their members.
Yeah, I think as well, I think going back to Mr Rennie's point around culture, and particularly with culture within the organisation, is that we think that that will be enhanced, or it will improve, or at least start to improve culture, if you have staff voice you have the ability for staff voice to be heard directly by the Board of Management, which currently they don't hear, and they are part of the decision-making process. So, you know, it goes to, if the government is really serious about cultural change, then part, and a very important part of that cultural change, has to be how staff voice is listened to, how they can ensure that they have that direct influence and communication with those people who are making the decisions ultimately. So, you know, we do, as Pauline has already stated, the current situation just doesn't allow us to do that. If you have someone who says that they are representing staff on that board of management right now, I really don't know how they've been able to carry out those duties, not having spoken to staff on a regular basis or at all, actually, in 5 years, or indeed with the trade unions. So, the staff feel very alienated from the board of management in relation to their everyday work and the pressures that they are under. That voice just isn't there. We now have a new chair of the board who at least is beginning to engage with the staff and with the trade unions, and that's a start. It's a good start, but it's still not sufficient. We still need that direct voice and that direct influence at that level.
So can I ask then, what's preventing it?
Well, because there's no engagement from the person who's supposed to, with staff, from the person who is there to represent and to have knowledge of the interests of staff. And the only way, so if we just go back, we just go to that same situation in the new organisation, then we're still at, well, square zero, never mind square one. So what's presenting it is lack of engagement. Well, you cannot represent a body of staff if you're not a member of that body of staff and if you don't at least have regular engagement and consultation.
Thank you.
And get people's feedback.
Yes. I'm going to pick up on that, if you don't mind, Pamela, because you've spoken about this representative on the board for the staff. Is the function of the individual, is it the individual that's not engaging, or is it the function of the role? And is there something that's stopping the representative from going out and doing the staff engagement that you're talking about? Do we need legislation for that board representative for staff to engage, to carry out the surveys, to do some of the engagement work that you're talking about? And a succinct answer, if you don't mind.
Yes, convener. We would not have that view. We would have the view that...
But no, it's not about what I'm asking. Is there anything stopping the representative that's there on the board for staff doing that engagement right now as legislation currently sits and is drafted? Or is it the individual that's not doing that?
Well, there isn't anything stopping it except the fact that no matter how much they do of that, they're never going to be properly representative of staff.
Well, so that's OK. Can we move now to Ross Greer now, please? Thank you.
Thanks, convener. Good morning. There's an interesting section in the
Unite response I'd just like to pick up on a wee bit, and I'll quote it so I'm not getting it wrong, where you said that the bill as it currently stands does not recognise the importance of qualification regulation in relation to the protection of the learner. There's nothing in the bill that would strengthen regulation of qualifications, and that this is a missed opportunity. Would you be able to expand a bit, just in the first instance, on what you see as weaknesses in the current regulation system? Because it sounds like you don't think the system as it currently stands is strong enough, and the bill's obviously been a missed opportunity there. I think it'd be helpful for the committee, before we talk about how to strengthen it, if you could just give us a bit of background as to why you think the current system's not delivering as much as it could.
Okay, well, the bill itself, the proposed bill itself, doesn't even mention regulation. I mean, there's nothing in regulation in the bill. To begin with, accreditation is a function of a regulation. It's not regulation in and of itself. And also, the current qualification regulation system is purely voluntary. It's not mandatory. The only aspect of regulation that is mandatory relates to a couple of types of qualifications, one of those being Scottish vocational qualifications or competence-based qualifications that sit within a modern apprenticeship. So other than that, there is no mandatory regulation of other types of qualifications, the many hundreds of different qualifications that are publicly funded and are delivered across colleges and in schools and so on. So the weakness in terms of the bill doesn't address that. It's still really not telling us what type of regulation system the government wants. There is still work being done on options around regulation, and there's nothing reflected in that in the bill. So there's not a great deal of change between what we have in the current bill that's set up SQA and the new proposed bill around this issue of accreditation. The only changes that we can see so far, and we're not experts in reading legislation and bills, and they are difficult to read, my sympathies with you all, actually, is around aspects of the work of the accreditation committee. That's about the sum of the changes made. Apart from that, nothing else has changed. So we've got a voluntary system. We've also got a system that is not properly resourced and funded to do the job that it's meant to do. So in accreditation, the accreditation team, there's 20 people. So from a human resource level, it's not particularly well resourced. From a funding position, our funding has stayed the same for 13 years. 13 years, we've had the same level of funding. That's how much value regulation has currently been placed on our qualification system. And we rely pretty heavily on some additional, not a lot, but some additional monies coming from the awarding arm of SQA. That's not proper independence. And I think the regulation and our members, and we cover, again, to say we're 20 members of staff that work in accreditation currently, and 90% of those members of staff are Unite members. So we feel quite comfortable and confident that the evidence that we presented on behalf of our colleagues within accreditation and regulation is really their views. And they do feel very disappointed that this, because we were told at the start, when we were told that our organisation was to be replaced, that there would be opportunities, we could see changes being made. And we clung on to the fact that we might get some opportunities here and see something change within regulation accreditation, whether it's further independence from the awarding body, government being very clear about the regulation system it wants in Scotland, or whether it's in terms of resourcing the work we currently do, you know, that it needs to do it as effectively as it possibly can do.
That's really useful. Thank you. Could you expand a little bit on, it sounds like Unite's position is that there are weaknesses to having a voluntary rather than mandatory system. Could you maybe just say a little bit about what those weaknesses are? And if you could just confirm your position is that in legislation it should become a mandatory system?
Well, we're not asking that necessarily that the system becomes all mandatory. I think that's a discussion and a debate and a policy position that needs to be taken somewhere at some point. It's just not happened yet, and yet we're seeing a proposed bill that, you know, is establishing or re-establishing accreditation function within Qualification Scotland, but it hasn't actually determined what type of regulation and accreditation system it wants.
Can I just, sorry to cut across, but just on that wider point around the engagement of your members, but particularly this team of 20 that you're talking about, there's a question here of consultation both on the bill, but also the operating model that's being developed for the body. To what extent are your members actually being engaged? To what extent were they engaged in the first place on the drafting of this bill, but also as we go forward on development of the operating model? Because a lot of the organisational arrangements obviously shouldn't be in legislation because that limits flexibility, but it is essential your members are consulted on that as well. It doesn't sound like that's happening, if I'm picking that up correctly.
It's been pretty poor, to be honest. Again, going back to Unite reps really fighting very hard every step of the way to have our voices heard, and that was right from the start of this process, so from when the decision was made to replace SQA. You know, we wrote to the Cabinet Secretary, for example, to ensure that our members' jobs were secured, our staff jobs were secured, to insisting that we got a seat at the delivery boards where these discussions and these decisions were being made, where, for example, the bill would have been discussed. However, that delivery board didn't really work particularly effectively, in that there was another group who were looking at the bill and writing that bill, drafting that bill, and we would occasionally find out where they were in that drafting of the bill. So there wasn't a huge amount of opportunity for us to shape in any way, shape or form that bill. Whether it was in relation to the accreditation function or more widely. So, you know, if you're asked where we get lots of meetings to discuss lots of things, yes, we were. But that doesn't equate to being in the room where the decisions have been made and having any kind of influence over the drafting of that bill, because we didn't.
Thanks very much. That's useful. Thank you.
Thank you, Ross.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. Sharon, just sticking with Ross Greer's questions, which I think are interesting, Muir recommended that the accreditation function be split from the awarding function, and the government initially agreed with that, but then reversed its position. And so the new bill, as I understand it, will be very similar to the current regime with an accreditation committee overseeing it, minor changes to that accreditation committee's membership. Now, your submission is concerned about that. Why?
Well, there are a number of reasons why. I think perception is very important for the work that we do. So, in accreditation, we approve and regulate 35 plus, might be 36 now, awarding bodies, and they offer a range of qualifications across Scotland. And they have to feel that we are truly independent from another awarding body, SQA. And we believe that as members of staff, and I'm talking particularly about the accreditation team here, that we work very hard to ensure there is that separation as far as we can do. However, you know, perception is really important. If you are telling other awarding bodies you're treating them exactly the same way as the largest national awarding body in Scotland, and you're sitting in the same building as them, and you have the same chief executive as them, and there's a lot of cross-fertilisation between board and accreditation committee, that is a hard sell. And regardless of how much we believe very strongly that we treat colleagues in SQA the same as any other awarding body colleagues in terms of looking at the quality of the qualifications that they bring forward to us. And in the audit activity that we carry out, it is a difficult one to sell. But also, we do think that, you know, regulation would have much more impact if there was that proper separation, and we'd be able to do more.
Let me challenge you on that then.
Okay.
Because Schedule 1 says specifically that the accreditation committee will be independent. And Sections 19 and 20 say that an accreditation committee must produce its own individual corporate plan. Mm-hmm. It must produce its own independent report. And I think Schedule 1 also goes on to say that the majority of members of the accreditation committee, the majority, mustn't be connected to, they mustn't be staff of, qualifications, the new Qualifications Scotland. Mm-hmm. You remain unconvinced, though. Why?
Because that's not any change from what we currently have. So currently, we have an accreditation committee that, you know, has a majority that are not members or staff. But we still have the chief executive sitting on that accreditation committee. The chair of that accreditation committee is a member of the SQA Board of Management. So there is still... Now, whether there's anything in that bill that would suggest that that can change, I don't see it. So it doesn't... It gives Qualifications Scotland the ability, as long as we're keeping the majority of seats on that committee for those external to Qualifications Scotland, it still allows for that cross fertilisation, if you like, between the two parts of the organisation.
So what would be Unite's solution? Is it to amend the bill such that there is a complete split, or perhaps there's something else, is it to bring in some kind of regulator like I understand there is in England?
Well, there's no reason why we can't be the regulator in similar to what currently happens in England. If legislation
Forgive
allows
me, Sharon,
us to do
we,
that.
The Unite the Union would be
current,
the regulator.
No, not Unite the Union. Right. The current accreditation team, who have the years, decades of experience in relation to regulation, audit and accreditation and quality assurance of qualifications. That's our day job. That's what we do. But as I said previously to another question, that's a voluntary situation we currently have within Scotland. It's whether it's proper that legislation includes the mandatory regulation of qualifications in Scotland and it establishes a regulator that has the powers that something an organisation like Ofqual has or Qualification Wales has, is something that's not been addressed.
But what do you think, if I may, because this committee wants to know what it should do. I've put it to you that there are provisions in the Education Bill that seek to preserve or to promote independence, but you are uncomfortable with those and think it doesn't do it. So what should we do?
Well, it's really not for Unite the Union or indeed our members to say exactly what should then happen, because that's a discussion and a debate, and it has to be an evidence-based decision around what's best in terms of regulation in Scotland. What do we really need? Is there a system whereby public money is being spent and there is no regulation of the quality of the delivery of the qualifications for young people and adults who are in, you know, who are upskilling or taking qualifications? That's a question that government and parliament has to make. What I'm saying and what our members are saying is that currently, as it's drafted, the bill will not allow the proper separation of those functions. Now, whether or not, I mean, there's two debates here, isn't there? There's one about where we should sit, so whether it should be within the current or within the new qualification body. If it does, could we do more to separate or make us more independent of that body? Yes, we think we could be. So we should have our own management systems, our own board of management, our own governance structures, those types of things. And we could share human resources, finance, those types of services. There maybe could be something there that we could be done. Whether you need a bill to do that, I'm not an expert in how legislation operates, but the bill does not appear to say more about the proper separation. It doesn't also talk about an identity for the qualifications regulator or accreditation body. It's very much tied to the identity of the awarding body, and that concerns the staff as well. Where's our identity? And also, when it comes to priorities for scant resources, certainly we are down very much down that list of priorities in terms of getting the tools we need to do our job.
Grateful, Convener.
Ross Greer, you've got something that's going to be useful.
Thanks, Convener. Much appreciated. One of the proposals to resolve this situation has potentially been to move the accreditation function into HMIE, because one of the government's key objections to separating it out has been the cost of creating a new public body. Ken, I'd be interested in your thoughts on whether moving it into HMIE would potentially be a solution, or whether that would cause other issues, whether we'd be resolving one arguable conflict of interest by creating another one.
I think potentially you'd be creating another problem there. There have been any number of observations that the current setup with us within Education Scotland, as in the Inspectorate, has created a conflict of interest. So therefore, you know, you are inspecting places where other members of the team have been involved in helping them, to giving them advice and so on. So as things are currently set up, I can't see how that would work particularly well. And I think given the current financial situation, it's unlikely we'd be able to be staffed to do that either. So, you know, it's not something that's been proposed in our direction, but it's difficult to see how that would work in practice.
Thank you very much. Bill Kidd now, over to yourself.
Thanks. Thank you, Convener. Thank you, everyone. Now, this committee has heard that some teachers, maybe more than just a few, see the inspection process as onerous, largely about accountability and not particularly helpful in all cases. Now, this appears to contradict what Education Scotland says about the inspection process. Now, is it possible to explain the difference in perception of inspections and what are actually the experiences of inspectors in visiting schools?
That's a very wide-ranging question. how long have I got? I was interested in some of the evidence that was given last week on this front, because listening to the representatives of the unions, it made it sound like when an inspection happens, then everything changes within a school and people are scurrying around and trying to create things. There's a little bit of that that happens, but to a certain extent, that tends to be self-inflicted. We don't look for those sorts of things, and it's referenced in the SPICE briefing paper that you have in front of you, that there's no real expectation that a school will provide you with anything other than a self-evaluation paper saying, here's where we think we are at. The rest of it is through conversation, through observation, through discussion, and so on. The way in which inspection tends to be looked at within the press, I think, is maybe about 20 years old, thereabouts. A lot is now is much more about how you actually work with people when you're in the schools, and an awful lot of it's to do with relationships as well. So the managing inspector will build up a relationship with the head teacher, come in, do the same with the staff, and a lot of it from there on in is more of a mentoring than a standing with your arms folded with a clipboard and deciding how well or otherwise things are going. So it tends to be characterised in a particular sort of way, and I think people are also influenced by the way in which things have been south of the border too. But it is a process which should be a way of helping schools to realise what's going well, and also through conversation to agree ways forward that things could actually get better. So there is more of a mentoring aspect to it there. Yes, there are currently evaluations, and that is something which is certainly under discussion. We don't, as a union, have a view on that. But I think if you speak to people who have been part of the inspection process, they tend to be nervous beforehand. They become more trusting of things as you go on, and then when they see that you're actually respecting the context of the school as well, they understand where you've got to by the end. And it's very much a snapshot as well, what is published. So it should be with rather than to. It should be something you're doing with the school rather than to them. And certainly since I joined the inspectorate, which is 15 years ago now, that has been the way in which we've operated, very much so. So, you know, I think the way in which it's talked about and the way in which it actually happens are two separate things.
So do you think then that negativity makes good press for the press, but not for the education sector? Basically, if something happens which is reported which is not for the best, that is the only reason for a story. They never report anything where school and its staff are actually praised or anything like that sort of thing.
I have worked in a local authority where that was certainly the case. It's not something the union has got a particular view on, but what we would be keen to ensure is where we're working with a school where maybe things aren't working out particularly well, that we also get involved with the local authority and encourage them to think about how they actually want to put forward the positives from that particular inspection into the press and make sure that those sorts of things are emphasised. So, yeah, there can be. And, well, you see the same on any news which is reported. You don't tend to get all that many good news stories. You get where the problems are.
Yeah, I understand that, Gemma. Can I just ask a wee...
A wee bit, so just watch in terms of encroaching into the next sort of thing.
Of course, yeah. No, it's just basically just to ask if teachers believe that they are benefiting from the inspections. Do they actually ever think that the teachers are benefiting rather than just being the target and so on? Do they?
I think that's part of my previous answer, which is before we go in, they tend to be concerned. And we have a point when we will do a staff briefing, which is more a question of here's who we are, let everybody see who the team is, and give them a chance to ask questions. They don't tend to ask questions because most of them are sitting there, you know, they've been, I suppose, what they've heard from other people has caused them to be worried about things. As the week progresses, then you tend to get knocks on the door, people coming along, asking questions. By the end of the week, you've built up a relationship with them, you've seen them in classes, you've talked to them about what they're doing, you've asked them why they've decided to do what they're doing, perhaps made some suggestions as well as to things they might want to consider. So it's different by the time you get towards the end of the process from where you are at the beginning.
Okay. Well, thank you very much for that.
Thank you, Mr. Kidd. George Adam, please.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, everyone. I just wanted to follow on, Ken, from what Bill had asked you there with regards to the actual inspections themselves and under the bill. Mm-hmm. Do you think they should be more prescriptive? Because we've had different views from different people and different organisations. Or do you believe that they should be more kind of flexible? Or, you know, the way you've described it there almost is a bit of both. You're there to do a job, and there is the kind of flexibility of how we get about that. But that's not what we heard from EIS and some of the other unions, teaching unions. So can you maybe just give me some kind of ideas on how you think the bill relates to that and how we go forward?
I think the bill, in many cases, as I said, I've worked as an inspector for 15 years, so I remember HMIE. I was part of that. I was appointed to there, and then we became Education Scotland in 2011. What's described is not a million miles away from how things used to be regarding what the scope actually is of what can be inspected. So, for example, initial teacher education is mentioned, but that has never happened. There are a lot of people who would be interested in getting involved with that side of things, and I think much here regarding how flexible and also how widespread inspections can be will depend on how things are funded and you know, what we have by way of a workforce as well to be able to do it. So, you know, we're doing 250 inspections a year at the moment. The majority of that is in primary, quite a few in secondary, some special. and so on. But it all depends, I suppose, how the finances are going to be configured, exactly what will be possible. Regarding different models of inspection, there have been many conversations in the past about what might be possible, and we've undertaken a whole range of different things. But I'm not aware of there being a settled view yet as far as the inspectorate is concerned regarding exactly what we'll do. Currently, we're continuing to do what we've done up to now, and also, as was observed earlier, were involved in the thematic inspections of local authorities.
I can understand how those that work in education can feel the difficulty, because last week we were told that there's a stress and there's a strain to the whole process to those working in teaching. And I can understand that because, you know, in my previous working life, I used to work in the motor industry and there was corporate sales. And when someone came in from the manufacturer into the dealership and said, "We're from the manufacturer, we're here to help," you never really thought that was the case. You know, it was a case of just getting by whatever the process was. So in the real world, you know, how do you think that you, so that we get to that stage where everybody's getting value to the inspectorate? You've had the inspection, there's been maybe some issues, these have been dealt with. How do we get to a place where everybody feels some value to it? Because I think this is part of the crux of the problem that we have. It's very similar to my previous life where everybody goes, "Oh, thank God, that's overdone with."
There's part of me that thinks you should be asking this question to HM Chief Inspector rather than me, rather than somebody who's
I'm just trying to get everybody's idea of how we go forward.
Yeah. I think we need a conversation about, and we've started it, about the way in which inspection works best. And as I said, there are a multiplicity of different views. You talked earlier on this morning about the possibility of the people just dropping in type inspections that Care Inspectorate do. There's no fixed view on this, I'm afraid. And I think we would welcome further engagement with the people who are involved with that as to what would work.
Nobody likes a mystery shop.
No, I don't think so. However, I mean, I suppose the benefit of just appearing is that nobody's had to go to all that stress and strain to do something that somebody's advised them they need to do before inspectors come in, which they don't. And therefore, you can just proceed as per normal as well.
Okay, well, just general for everyone. Obviously, do any of the panel members have a view on the different types of educational establishment that should be part of the inspectorate under the bill?
Fine. We were expecting another rep.
Yes. Yeah. Well, unfortunately, Alan Sampson was unable to make it. He's our national officer, so he's got a broader remit, I suppose, than simply education. We've expressed our concerns within the response about where Post 16 sits at the moment, and that's an area where the responsibility for the inspection actually doesn't sit with Education Scotland, or indeed with the inspectorate that sits within it at the moment, and also with Community Learning and Development, which has not been as active as they'd like to be. So I suppose it's trying to make sure that we're making the most of the staff that we actually have.
Thank you.
Can I follow up on that one, Ken, in terms of specifically in ELC, early learning? Mm-hmm. You know, there is the bill will mean that it's double inspected to an extent with both the Care Inspectorate and yourselves. So what are your thoughts on that and what the consequences might be?
Okay, I think there are still a number. It's not an area I'm any sort of expert in, but we have got a situation at the moment where there's still things which have got to be ironed out. But what I can say is that both the inspectorate that sits within Education Scotland and also the Care Inspectorate work extremely well together. And whilst we've not got to the stage where we've got a finalised version of the, you know, how they would go about doing things jointly, they do work well as it happens at the moment when you're both involved in the same inspection in the same place at the same time.
Okay, that's perhaps something for the committee to follow up on.
I think so. Yes, yeah, if you would like a written submission on that, I can certainly organise that.
Yeah, yes, that would be helpful.
Thank you.
I want to ask some other things about how effective the inspectorate's been in providing feedback, system level feedback to ministers in terms of the inspections. And do you consider that provisions of the bill provide sufficient independence to allow the future inspectorate to fulfil its role effectively, because there has been discussions whether or not the inspectorate role should report to ministers or report to Parliament, etc. So where's...
Yeah, if I can take it in reverse order, and please remind me of the first part of the question when I finish the last part. There certainly has been a perspective within the general public, certainly within the wider education system, that what the inspectorate has been doing whilst part of Education Scotland has very much been at the direction of ministers, and that the relationship has become closer. So I think to a certain extent, moving slightly back from that will be helpful. We have, as a union, been regularly involved with the relevant cabinet minister, and talking to them, the cabinet minister for education. For whatever reason, during the beginning of the reform period, those meetings were regular, and since that point, the meetings have become less frequent, and in fact, we haven't had one for more than a year now, which is a bit of a, you know, it's difficult for us to understand exactly why that is, why the Cabinet Secretary is not engaging with us about the members and how reform is proceeding. And through that, staff have obviously remained focused on supporting educators and improving outcomes for young people. Can you remind me of the first part?
I was asking about how effective the inspectorate has been, so that's what's going on right now, in terms of providing that system-level feedback to the ministers. But you,
OK. Yeah. Right. The thematic inspections, I think, are helpful on that front. Part of what we used to do got lost a few years ago, and I think would be helpful. And I think there's a general agreement this is something which we need to bring back. There were officers, I was one myself, called area lead officers, which were HMIs who were linked to individual local authorities. The job there was both to support and challenge them. So you were looking at the attainment data and how well inspections were going, but you were also getting involved with the councillors, finding out about the direction of travel, and it meant you had the relationships with the people within the local authority, but you also had a significant amount of information there about how well things were going within the individual local authorities. And that then meant, as a body, we were able to be part of the risk assessments that were done with the other scrutiny bodies about how well things were going within that particular authority, and also to be able to plan your involvement more generally, in a more strategic way with that individual authority. When we had those people in place, then I think we had a much better idea of how well things were going across the nation. And we also had the relationships with the directors of education, the conveners of the education committees, and so on. To a certain extent, that has been lost, but I think there's certainly an appetite to bring that back. So we have some information on the basis of the inspections and the thematics, which we have by way of a national picture, but I think there are ways in which, as we move forward, we could actually make that even stronger.
I know you will have heard the panel that were in before you, Mr McCarra. Mm-hmm. Some were suggesting there needs to be a bit better or some communication around the inspection process with both pupils and parents. What were your thoughts on that?
Well, we do involve parents quite a lot. Could it be more? Probably. The pupils one is an interesting one. Part of my role is to work with the care inspectorate on their joint inspections of children's services. And that was what was being hinted at regarding young inspection volunteers, because those have got representatives from Education Scotland, Care Inspectorate, the HMICS, the Police Inspectorate, and also Health Improvement Scotland. But there are also young inspection volunteers who are those who have been care experienced at some point, might still be, and are in further education. They have training, they come along with us, and when we have the engagement week with the local authority, where we're speaking to focus groups and individuals, then they will be part of that. And we tend to find that they ask the most probing questions. And quite often you can see those who are being asked the questions sitting back a little bit because they weren't expecting it to be quite so direct. It's more complicated, I think, if we're going to be doing that with school pupils, but I don't think it's necessarily impossible. And no doubt it would be possible to pilot something like that. But it's, you know, we speak to pupils a lot when we're in schools, but having somebody who's a peer from somewhere else might well be helpful.
Thanks. So just to go back a little bit, do you think that the bill provides the SAT sufficient independence to allow the future inspectorate to really fulfil its role effectively?
I think it does. And I think it's helpful that we're separating the curriculum functions from scrutiny. And as I said earlier, it makes it seem less like we're marking our own homework. What's in there in large part is what was there previously for the inspectorate. So I suppose the concerns that people tend to have about the reform process are not really to do with the bill. They're not really to do with the provisions which are in the bill. They're more like what it's going to be like to work for the new inspectorate. So it's back to previous conversations about culture, really.
That's helpful, Ken. Thank you. John Mason, thanks.
Thanks, Convener. And maybe to follow on from the Convener's line of questioning, there's the proposal for an advisory council for the Chief Inspector going forward. So I'm interested in all your views as to how that would work, because there's also the idea that maybe young people should be involved in that, or teachers or whoever. So, Mr. McCarra, any thoughts on the advisory council? Good thing, bad thing?
A good thing, I think. It's something we've never really had in that kind of way. So I think having those who are involved in the inspection process together to advise is helpful. It's not something we feel we need to be part of as union representatives. We've got a partnership agreement which is based on the Fair Work principles. We're happy with that. We've got other ways in which we can feed in.
Because other unions want a majority on everything, as Mr. Adam was pointing out earlier.
Yeah. Yes. No, we have a range of different ways in which we get involved with our management and with our members, which means that we are able to sort of have a regular forum to be able to express the views of our members, which we get together on a regular basis. We have other ways in which we can contact strategic directors, the CEO and so on, to be able to raise particular things with them. So we're not seeing a need for us as far as that's concerned. But I'm aware that may well be different for SQA.
And do you have different views as to who should actually be on the advisory council, or are you relaxed about that?
I'm relaxed about that.
Okay. Do you not have a view? You seem to.
We wouldn't have a view in relation to the governance arrangements within HMIE, because we don't have a depth of knowledge of those structures to be able to comment meaningfully on.
So, in principle, you wouldn't ask for a strong union voice on everybody. You would just ask for the ones that you know about.
No, in principle, we would ask for a strong union voice on everybody, yes. But in terms of, Ken's the expert in terms of how the organisation works. And as Ken mentioned, they have got in place things other than a representative on the advisory council, which satisfies their members. So I just have to take that. Or obviously, I don't have any, or neither of us have any intimate knowledge.
It strikes me we could end up with quite a mixed picture here if we had a majority of the EIS in some places and no union representative elsewhere, mm-hmm. and Unite somewhere in the middle. Mm-hmm. But we can be relaxed about that.
I think it does depend on the nature of the agency, how it operates, the internal structures, but also what it does. So does it make sense for the EIS, for example, to have a representative on the Board of Management at the New Qualifications Scotland? Absolutely. Because it's important that if there are one or two teacher representatives on the new Board of Management, that they are representative of teachers, that they are not some individuals selected because they are a teacher. So it's about the voice and being able to represent the voice of teachers, or whether it's college lecturers, it would be EIS FELA, I assume. There is a need to ensure there's proper representation and representatives on those boards. Otherwise, you're just getting a group of individuals giving their own perspective on things.
Okay, thank you. And to move on then, secondly, to the actual process of moving into the new structures, and I've picked up from the evidence that staff have been unsettled by the lengthy period of this and uncertainty as to where they fit in and so on. Can you give us any update, give you all the chance to speak, about where we are in that transition process? Are staff feeling any more comfortable and relaxed about it? Are they clearer about what's going to be happening? Or do we have to get the bill through first before we can really go there? Ms. Roger?
Oh, right. How our staff are feeling and how our members are feeling. Our members, I think, and Willie had said that we've got a variety of views on various different other matters, but I would say it would be safe to say that none of our members believe that this bill, as it stands, will achieve what the aspiration of the country is for it to achieve. The primary reason for that is nothing to do with leadership, is nothing to do with culture, it's to do with finance. None of our members believe that there will be sufficient resource and finance to actually transform, I've forgotten what we're called, Qualification Scotland. I was going to say Education Scotland there, I'm really sorry. So
does that make the staff, if they're already a bit uneasy, that just makes them feel more uneasy because things are not going to get any better? Is that
absolutely. I can expand on that. Right. And obviously Sharon has mentioned the fact that staff have been living under a cloud of uncertainty for 3.5 years. The staff are highly professional, highly dedicated. They get their head down and get on with the job. But they do not know what the future holds for them. We, as a union, managed to get reassurances, they were not automatically given to us, that there would be no compulsory redundancies. But that doesn't tell anyone within the organisation what their roles are going to be. Are they going to have a job they actually want to have? What are the structures going to be? So we've been living under that cloud for 3.5 years.
That would suggest that you want things to get decided as soon as possible.
Oh, well, we would have loved them for clarity about that. But, and this committee will be aware, the Scottish Government has written to all public sector bodies and said there has to be, unless it's in dire circumstance, dire need, there has to be a recruitment freeze. And that has, in recent months, had a huge impact on staff, which then has resulted in a further drop in morale.
And does that not give some reassurance that if there's nobody new coming in, their present jobs are quite safe?
Oh, no, I can describe to you what the impact of that is. It's nothing to do with no one new coming in. It's about no one who leaves getting replaced, which is a completely different thing. So, three examples for you, although there are more. A reform team was set up, and you're talking about the progress towards that. People within the organisation were seconded into that reform team, wholly to focus on working across the organisation, to look at things like structures, to work on culture and what people were expected to do. Those people were seconded into those posts. Their posts were filled, ultimately backfilled, because their posts were day job posts and that work was still going on. Some people were backfilled ultimately, some were backfilled externally because we don't have a kind of never-ending pool of staff. And because there was no funding to carry that on, they were all on seconded contracts, which are obviously not permanent contracts in that role. And because of lack of funding to take that forward, they were all disbanded back to their doing good work, back to their substantive posts. And then you have a domino effect. And unfortunately, the people at the end of that domino rally end up with no jobs.
Okay? So can you clarify for me this reform team? So the reform team was set up, but nothing much is happening. So it's effectively not there anymore.
No, there was plenty happening. And obviously, we're supposed to be getting reformed, so there should be something happening. But there's no funding from the Scottish Government to keep that team going. So therefore, we can't run it.
So the reform team is not happening?
No, the reform team, it doesn't exist anymore.
Right, OK, that's
so clear. Any reform activity has to be absorbed by other staff who have full-time day jobs already and who are not able to be seconded out to focus on.
So it's an extra for
job.
People's normal work.
Absolutely. Okay. Another example, and I'm sure, and this speaks to culture. SQA has, and I think it's since CFE review, seconded in practising teachers into roles called subject implementation managers. Now, initially, those subject implementation managers, it was permanent, they were made permanent, those roles, but subsequently, because obviously we can all see the cloud of finance in the looming over us, they were recruited in on temporary contracts, okay, which were extended. The whole focus of those people's roles was directly engaging and supporting teachers and lecturers who were delivering these qualifications. That was the whole focus of their role.
The convener's going to jump in my head.
Get to the point,
right,
please.
So, their roles those who are on a temporary contract, they are now no longer within the organisation. So that work is not going ahead. Okay. And we have finally another team that was told last week, a team that is working on innovative ways of developing qualifications in true partnership, directly with colleges and helping to reform them on their own. A team of 13 people have now had those temporary contracts. They will be due to be renewed at the end of December. They are not going to be renewed, and some of that team will have no job
by
the end of December.
That's helpful. I'm going to have to stop you. That gives us ammunition. We can raise that with the Minister and so on. So that's very helpful. And if you want to follow up, send us more stuff afterwards.
Yeah,
Ms McGuigan, anything to add?
I think we would want to send you to that information. I mean, the morale within the organisation is really low, very low, because we're juggling a whole range of things here. Business as usual, so we still need to deliver everything we're meant to deliver. We've had reform over us for 3.5 years, and staff not really been fully and properly engaged in that reform in terms of meaningful consultation in relation to, you know, the what jobs might look like, what the structures might look like. We're just not there yet. We've had no conversations about what the structure of the new organisation may look like. And it doesn't really, and there's still no conversations about that.
And presumably that can't really happen till the bill's through.
Well, could it not? I mean, there are already decisions being made around bringing to the end fixed-term contracts, moving around responsibilities in some areas, and all this done without any consultation with the trade unions. And I think so that has an impact. People see what currently has been done within the organisation, the jobs that are being lost, the reform work that we all want to engage in and believe in being withdrawn. And we have a whole organisation reform and restructure still to happen. Our members are really concerned about the impacts on them, future jobs, and how they will be treated within the organisation.
It's helpful. I just wanted to get a feel of how things were going.
It's not good.
Okay, I got it. Mr McCarra, anything to add on that?
A lot which is similar. Basically, it's been 3.5 years of very, very little information, despite asking for it on a regular basis. We had meetings from time to time with the Scottish Government Reform Unit, asked for milestones at least regarding what was going to be happening when. It was agreed that would be a good idea. We've had something approaching that in the last couple of weeks, but with very little detail in there. And part of the problem for that, I suppose, is we've got the inspectorate will become separate, and so people there have got a reasonable idea as to what that's going to look like. It's the people in the rest of Education Scotland that we also represent who are less clear. So they're not clear about their particular jobs. I mean, we've got a no compulsory redundancy agreement, but that's as far as it goes. So they're wondering if the current job will remain, how it will look, who they'll be working with, and so on. And that kind of uncertainty is making people particularly anxious. And as I said, it's gone on for 3.5 years, and we've got another year or so of that to go before things conclude at the least. So, yeah, it's been very, very difficult for people. And as you were saying, all the while keeping on with the day job as well.
OK, well, I think you've given us a good picture of that, so we've got that message.
Thank you, John. That's great. Liam Kerr, do you want to pick something up there?
Yeah, thanks, Convener. Just a very quick question on something that you said to John Mason, Pauline Roger. This committee is obviously considering the bill and trying to make sure that it does what the government wishes it to do. You said in response to John Mason that there's not enough finance. Now, if you've quantified that there's not enough, logically you would have gone on to say, well, what would be enough? So can Unite the Union tell us how much extra is needed to make this work?
Well, there needs to be funding for people to work on reform. If we're the people, we had funding for people to work on reform. We don't have that anymore. So people who are doing very busy day jobs, with the best will in the world, cannot dedicate their time to helping bring about meaningful reform and to bringing staff in for that.
Yeah, I do understand that. Forgive me in talking over you. I do understand that. I'm looking for a figure so that this committee can look at and say, that's what we need to
make
this work.
We've not seen the books, I'm afraid, Liam. So we can't say. There has to be sufficient money. There has to be sufficient funding for the staff who will need to take forward this reform. And also, and I know, Willie, you talked about culture, and it's been a very big theme. You cannot change a culture when people are beleaguered because they're not only doing their day job, they're also doing other jobs that should be funded and that should be there to support teachers and lecturers. So nobody's opened the books to us. I'm sorry, Liam.
Okay. Yeah. Very much. Jackie Dunbar, thank you very much.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, panel. Could you give us some insight in where you are in regards within your organisations about how much focus is being put on? I'm getting myself all confused. To ensure, you know, we're looking at the needs of our diverse learners and making sure that they're met. So what's happening within your organisations and your members, and what are they doing to reflect that this is happening?
Right, so probably I can answer some of that and tell you some of that, but and I would ask my colleagues SQE to forgive me this, I don't have an in-depth knowledge across the entire organisation. There is a lot of work going on at the moment in terms of accessibility of all the material that we have, of our website, to make that as fully accessible as we can to learners who might want to be using it, but also potentially to other people with an interest, parents, obviously teachers, lecturers. So there's a lot of work going on within the organisation in that area, which is designed to support not just learners, but others as well. But it will in itself help learners who potentially have difficulties accessing technology, but just difficulty accessing things in a normal fashion. We do also have, and I do not have an in-depth knowledge of this, but we do have a dedicated area within operations who work every year with schools to put in place special arrangements for learners who cannot access their qualifications through simply writing on pen and paper, people who might need a scribe, people who might need electronic papers, and maybe do their stuff online. So there's a lot of work goes on in that area for those taking the qualifications itself. And embedded in the development of qualifications, that is an area that has to be thought about and deliberated in terms of how the qualifications are structured so that they don't put in place artificial barriers that will exclude those potentially with special educational needs. So that's built into to that process. And there was something else which has just escaped me. I'm sorry, you can't think of.
No, I think what we do in accreditation in the development of qualifications and national occupational standards to, is to ensure accessibility from the start of that development. And we have regulatory principles in place which allow us to question awarding bodies around their accessibility arrangements, equal opportunity arrangements and so on. And we have
the members do that on a day-to-day basis. Have they got the ability to feed that back?
Well, we operate on a system of audit reports and centre visit reports which are publicly available. And we can continue to have conversations with any awarding body that's not has an issue around equal opportunities and accessibility arrangements. And that becomes maybe a condition on that awarding body if they are failing in that area. So we have a number of regulations around what they must do in that area. And if they fail to meet those, then there are conditions placed on those awarding bodies.
And the focus for being able to do that, would you say that's quite high in your organisation? Or?
It is pretty high in the organisation, probably more so this last couple of years, I think, particularly. It's always been high, yeah. But it had to get better. Mm-hmm. And I think we are making moves towards really making a difference there. And I think just being much more aware of what's happening. And that also comes down to the training of staff too. Staff need development, staff need training. Staff always need to be on top of these things. Sadly, with the current financial cuts, staff development is a bit low down in the priority list at the moment. But we need to be keeping on top of these things. But we need to also learn and know and understand so that we can hopefully support change.
Okay. Mm.
It's very much a part of what we naturally do, because when we're out in schools, then we're looking at meeting learning needs, we're looking at inclusion, equality and wellbeing. And you know, every single inspector is involved in looking at those particular things. So you're keeping an eye open for those. You're asking teachers about them. You're looking for ways in which they're differentiating what's happening in the classroom and so on. I'm part of what's called the special team. That's because we look at the special sector as well as the mainstream sector. And we're involved with training for colleagues on a whole range of different things there, so that people's understanding and skill levels about looking at things such as alternative communications devices and so on is where it needs to be for that as well. Internally, we're also thinking about accessibility, health and safety and well-being for colleagues, and we've got people who sit in our committee for that. So they're looking at things like safety of workers who are on their own somewhere else within the country, about safe travel arrangements and any special arrangements that people would require to help them to do their work.
And is there anything that you would like to see coming forward that would help in that regard?
I don't know that there's anything that needs to be specified in legislation.
Okay. Thank you.
That's great. Thank you very much. And thank you, panel. Thank you for your evidence this morning. Yes. And that concludes the public part of our proceedings. I'll suspend the meeting to allow our witnesses to leave. And then we will move into private session to consider our final agenda items. Thank you very much.